Okay. All right. Well, welcome everyone to the October 12th Hadley Tri-Board meeting. So we have representatives from the schools as well as the finance committee here with us. And we are expecting at least one other select board member. But we'll go ahead and get started. So I think the focus of tonight's tri-board meeting is to talk about the public forum that we're planning on holding next Wednesday, October 19th. At Hopkins Academy at 6:30. It's scheduled for 2 hours, and the primary focus of that is to provide anyone who's interested in attending with as much information as possible about the warrant articles that they will then be voting upon the following week at our special town meeting, which is being held on Thursday, October 27th at 7 o'clock at Hopkins Academy. So maybe just a couple of clarifying points if we can all agree on it, and then wanted to talk about the format for that, and then talk a little bit more about the warrant tonight. Does that work for you?
The format for the meeting or for the forum?
For the forum.
Okay.
Yeah. So is it okay if we start there? You okay with that, Annie?
Yes, of course.
Okay. So just a couple of things that make sure that we're all in agreement on. What I've been telling people at any rate, but I think it's what we agreed upon, at least at the select board level, is that the intention of the forum is to be informational in nature. It is to respond to to first and foremost provide people with the context within which they'll be voting, you know, so give people a sense of the bigger financial picture, and then also provide people with a sense of what exactly does a warrant article mean. Because sometimes there's, you know, confusion on town meeting floor and questions are asked that actually relate to, I'm not clear on what I'm voting for here, can you explain it? So we would walk through what exactly the warrant article means, what it doesn't mean, what a yes vote means, so that's clear in people's minds, and what a no vote means. And then expect that, again, there may be individuals there who would like to ask clarifying questions, but what we're not doing is advocating for any particular article, nor will we, should we be allowing for anybody at the meeting to be advocating. It's really just information so people can walk away encumbered with more facts to make a good decision the following week. So just as kind of an overarching theme, is everybody comfortable with that approach? Mm-hmm. Yep.
More information is good.
More information is good. Okay, Donald, you comfortable with that?
It's fine. It's exactly what we said at the staff meeting this afternoon.
Yep, good. And Jerry, you too? Okay. Jenny?
Are you anywhere along the line going to make a recommendation to any articles?
Are we ever, I mean, before October 27th? Yes.
Yeah. When would that be?
I don't know. We may be voting on some of them tonight.
I'll be asking for those.
Right. Yep. To the extent possible. Yeah.
Okay.
So just in terms of format for the public forum, so obviously welcome and thank you for people for coming. Kind of recap what was just said in terms of what the intent of the forum is. So providing overview and a context, improve the voters' understanding of the articles, and offer voters an opportunity to ask clarifying questions. Make it clear what we're not doing. And then, David, I think you and Linda were working on some financial overview slides.
Mm-hmm. Which we're prepared to show tonight.
Okay. Yeah. Do you want to? So the thought would be then that folks would give some of these financial slides, and then at that point, once that's presented, we would go into the actual articles one by one.
We're going to be presenting a handout to go with this slide as well, so that people are able to keep track of it as they go. David?
Yeah, so I had envisioned several handouts, one of which would be our standard rules and procedures for any public hearing, which includes a sign-up sheet, and the fact that people need to have read the warrant, that comments be limited to 3 minutes, and that they be directed to the chair. And if there's any follow-up comments, we certainly will address those. But just so that we could have an orderly and expeditious run-through of all the articles. We have 22 articles, so and only 2 hours to present all of this information, so we want to make sure that happens. So the other handout, which may be on the back of the rules and regulations for the public hearing, would be some ABCs of what the town meeting is all about. So what is the role of the moderator? What's the role of the finance committee? How, you know, what are the nuts and bolts of a town meeting? And then the warrant, obviously, and then we'd also have other financial information for people in order to illuminate some of the concepts that we're trying to convey here.
Do we have any opportunity to pass over some of the less controversial articles so that we can concentrate on, as you said, there's 2 hours that we're going to be here mm-hmm. to discuss this thing. If we can tonight possibly identify some of the ones that we think that we shouldn't waste a lot of time with in an effort to try to concentrate more time on the more important articles.
One of the things that I'll be talking about in the handout is the role of the consent agenda, and I've identified 5 articles that could be covered by consent, so that would be the opportunity for us to say these are non-controversial. They don't involve money. We certainly can debate them, but they're not as prone to attracting debate as some of the other articles. So out of the 22, we can take 5 of them under the consent and move on to where we really are interested in.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I guess my only question is, who's going to be the moderator, you as chairman or David?
So Brian West is going to be present, but he doesn't want to moderate.
That's correct.
That's correct?
Yes.
Right. So I certainly can.
I would like to have somebody there with a gavel.
Yeah.
That way you can call somebody out of order
mm-hmm.
and one person doing it the whole way. So I think that could be your responsibility if you want to do it. I think it'd be good.
I have no problem.
Was Brian holding out for more money?
That's what I'm saying.
maybe because I'm losing my mind, but Jerry, I think I remember that you had offered to moderate.
Oh, yes. No, it's all coming back to me.
A lot of experience there.
It is all coming back to me because you are the experienced.
I'd be happy to do it.
You know the Marquis of Queensbury rules?
Yes.
Yes.
Maybe we can find somebody else along the way, but I'd be happy to do it if Brian doesn't want to do it.
Okay. All right. So do you want to go through the handouts that you have?
All right. So we were, is Linda here?
Yes.
There you are.
Yeah.
We were looking at big picture, and we wanted to find out what the impact, the financial impact of all the borrowing articles together. That would be everything that's on this warrant, all the capital items, the equipment, the trucks, the building modifications, as well as the new buildings and the studies that we need to do, the soil analysis for the dike to make sure that we have a sound structure as part of our infrastructure system, as well as the MS4 permit requirements. So taking all of those together and thinking, okay, we're going to borrow for all of this, and we have a library that's going to come online in the next 2 years. What does that look like? And our chief financial advisor has provided for us 3 scenarios of what that may look like.
Who's the advisor?
Our chief financial advisor is Mr.
David Eisenhall
of Unibank.
Yeah, he's from Whittonsville?
That's correct. I think he's based out of Hartford now.
And how do we choose him?
We chose him a long time ago. He's been our chief financial advisor for decades. Very well regarded in the industry. very proficient at what he does, has a good, good reputation in cities and towns. So I'm going to give a handout. You've seen this before.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, so if you remember, we had a forum on the overall financial situation of the town back in September, and one of the slides that we used was a primer on the tax base and what are the components that make up for the tax base. And it's worth our while to go back to this slide because it will help us focus our conversation when I do the next handouts. So just as a refresher, the tax base is made up of the levy limit from the prior year, and then you have the 2.5% automatic increase on top of that. Then you have your new growth, and then you have your debt exclusion, or in some other towns, not Hadley, there's an override, but in Hadley we have debt exclusions. So those four components make up the taxes. So when we send out tax bills, that's the layer cake that we have, yes.
If you have a new municipal building, does it go into the increased levy limit?
Yes, at the debt exclusion part of it. All right. So. If you look at the top layer of this particular layer cake here, where it says debt exclusion,
yeah, next for the next year, it counts as new growth. The value of a new building.
That stays.
Yeah, if it's a commercial, if it's a taxable structure, yes, but a municipal building would not be taxable, so there would be no new growth associated with a municipal building, but there would be debt exclusion and. So that top layer is the next thing that we're talking about. We've offered, David prepared for us three scenarios, and I've color-coded them, the green, yellow, and red. If you haven't guessed, we're kind of leaning towards the green.
Excellent choice of color.
Yes, green, green, go. So the green one is called the plateau.
No.
Mm-hmm.
No. Nope. Sorry, the flattest. Thank you. Flattest. All right, the red that I'm handing out is the staircase.
The only problem is this green one is the staircase.
Did I screw that up?
I think you did.
I did. Sorry for my language on TV.
Okay, so you can guide us to the proper color.
Yeah, yellow. Yellow is going to be the favorite color.
Can you make the print a little bit bigger, this?
Well, there's a lot of information. So let's start with the one that's called staircase.
The green one. What color?
Green.
It would be green. And Linda, feel free to chime in.
All right.
And we'll wish. Okay, so the first page here has a lot of numbers in microscopic script. But we can turn to the second page. And here in graphic form is what we're talking about. You'll see that there are two slopes represented in the graphic.
David?
Yeah.
I think they're Houston. The light gray area that I have on the copy that I had previously came out, but on the copies that are in front of everybody right now, the only thing that came out was the existing. debt.
Oh, okay, the copy roll, because it's all right.
Might be able to change the resolution on it. See if it can print.
All right, so let's run these off.
Is that true of all three?
All three. Yeah, all three for the same.
You're gonna have to darken that up for the contrast. I'm sorry about that. So I apologize for the graphic issues here.
You haven't talked through it.
So we looked at where we are with respect to the existing debt that we've already authorized and bonded for, and that should be the only color that's visible on your handouts at this point. Okay, so if you notice that there's the y-axis has a number associated with it, and it looks like about of the mill rate, which is $1.15, the tax rate is $11.15. Of the $11.15, 90 cents of that is existing debt that we're paying off. And you notice that that existing debt drops off pretty precipitously in the next few years and finally goes away to nothing. Then we would be absolutely debt free at that particular point. We have an opportunity to fill in that drop with capital items, and we should. Our current debt capacity is at around 6% of net operating revenues, which is on the low end of our ideal range. We should be either between 6% at a low range or 10% at the high range. If our debt service is above 10% of our net operating revenues, then that becomes a burden. That's too much debt. If it falls below 6%, then that's too little debt, and we're not keeping up with our capital needs.
And we're at what now?
We're at 6% right now.
Who established that formula?
The formula was established by our former auditors, Powers and Sullivan, and in conformance with the best management practices established by the International County City Managers Association. So, but it makes sense. If you have too much debt, then it's a burden.
Right.
If you don't have enough debt, then you're just setting yourself up for a fall, because you know that you will need to fund something in the future, roofs or buses or bridges or roads or
and everything.
And we recognize that more debt takes away from the operating budget if we maintained an even tax rate.
If that debt is within the levy, yes. But
yeah.
I'm talking.
But I mean that squeezes the operational budget.
Right. Yeah. So we're talking about excluded debt, which would not squeeze the operational budget. So it would be debt that would be there would be that top layer of the layer cake.
Yeah.
All right.
But on the warrant, on the articles in the budget, the second to the last article is debt and interest. And that's right now it's about $1 million a year.
Thank you.
That's right. Sister.
Mm-hmm. That's as good as it goes.
If we incur more debt, that number increases.
That's right. It's just
how
much more.
Yeah.
If, yes.
So,
yes.
The proposal here is if we kept that line at 11.15, right, how much would we be spending? Somewhere around $300,000 to $400,000?
So 90 cents would be your total debt payment out of that 11.15.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's 90 cents per thousand.
I'll be back.
90 cents per thousand, and that's what you have right now.
Which is almost a 10% increase in what we've got now.
There's no increase here. I'm talking about current conditions. So right now, the tax bill that you pay, it's $11.15 per thousand.
Mm-hmm.
Of that $11.15, 90 cents of that is debt service.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So
approximately 10%. Give or take a couple of percent.
Yeah. All right. Give or take of the bill rate.
Mm-hmm.
So, given all the warrant articles plus the planned library building, what would be the impact upon the tax rate? And again, we're just talking about that top layer of the layer cake. what would be the impact? And we came up with three scenarios, or David Eisenthal came up with three scenarios. The first one that we have in front of you is called Staircase, and where you go from, in a very short period of time, over a two-year period, you go from 90 cents up to just shy of $1.40 for your debt service. So that's a big increase, but the advantage is that you plateau for a few years, and then you have these steps down over time, which gives you the opportunity to add more capacity, more debt, and more capital articles that you know are coming up. You've got the highway garage, you have Russell School at some point, we have to do something about that. We have capital needs in all the departments that need to be addressed. So it would be a steep increase in the first couple of years, and then you'd have some planned decreases that you could then backfill with other known capital needs. So this is the first scenario that was developed.
And what is the criteria for it to go from 90 to 139? What gets added?
Okay, so that's all the articles that are borrowed in this warrant, all the articles that have been authorized for borrowing, but we have not borrowed for yet, and a library. So you've got 3.5 buildings and all the equipment and all the debt that's been authorized but hasn't been borrowed for. Right. So that's all of it.
So now that total you've got there is $2,038,000, according to that email you just sent.
What's?
That's the debt. $362,000.
Okay.
Outstanding.
I have no idea.
$695,000 for 17, and $695,000 borrowing for all special time.
Right. Those were already authorized. The $362,000. Well, when it rolls over, it'll be new debt again, because we're going to pay off about half of that in June. The distinction he made, the very dark parts, is what we have already have in notes.
Okay.
Already. They're in bonds or a ban already. What we haven't borrowed for is that $695,000 we haven't borrowed for, but we're committed to borrow for that.
Okay.
So that's going to be in new borrowings. The rollover from the ban, the $190,000, that's going to be in the new borrowings. And then everything that's on the fall town meeting.
$981,000,
yes, which are the non-building capital articles.
Okay.
I have a little discrepancy. I'm not sure, he and I, we're off by about $30,000, so that's why I put the question mark, but that's real stuff.
Yeah, according to this email, with the three buildings, is $10 million.
That's correct.
Not including interest.
Well, none of this includes interest. The interest is one of the factors in these scales,
We're all on the same page here.
Yeah. How soon you borrow it, whether you're doing it under a ban or a bond, and how quickly you want to pay it off. Those are all swing factors.
Interest is a little tricky right now.
Yeah.
Because nobody knows where it's going to go. Certainly the Fed has been threatening to raise it over the last several years. They remain with their holster firmly and the gun in the holster trying to refill it. But,
we're going to be fixed if we borrow it anyway?
I'm sorry, I was
saying. It's going to be fixed if we borrow it?
When we go into a bond, it becomes fixed.
Okay.
So yeah. That's, you know, it's a higher interest rate, but you maintain it over 20 years, as opposed to getting a ban where you can get the currently the lowest available interest rate, this year was less than 1%, and you might be able to get that for a couple more years. So if we borrow with bans for a little bit, but then you risk the interest rate on the bonds going up.
Yeah.
So it is a juggling act. We're trying to keep it so that the total cost isn't thrown off by high interest rates, and we get some of that principal paid off early.
I understand this, but what I'm looking at is that $1.40, if that interest rate happens to change,
well,
and the rates are are raised on us?
Well, let's...
Then what will that do to it?
Let's touch on two things.
One more question, though, before we get to that.
Sure.
When we go up on this, that assumes the levy dropping off as well. So as I see the levy drop off and we're at 139, if we fund everything here, go to the 139, that's assuming the levy falls off as it shows here on the chart.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
And so everything from 90 to 139 will require a debt exclusion vote.
That's correct.
Okay.
So the other thing is that we've made this as conservative as possible. It's got everything in it. It's got a high interest rate, 5%, which we don't expect. And we've front-loaded some of this so that we could pay this off a little bit more aggressively. The next one that goes around is the
plateau.
We return to the existing tax rate 12 years from now.
That's about right.
So let's talk through the plateau for a moment, because some of the decision points are different here. In the plateau, you have a more gradual increase, and the increase is not as high. Start at the 90 cents, which is what our current conditions are, and you go to about $1.30, not $1.40, and it takes you longer to get there. And once you're there, then you have a stable tax rate for the period of about 10 years. And then you start seeing the debt being paid off. And at that point, you have the capacity for some of your other planned capital expenses, new fire truck, or whether that be a town garage or so. So the tax rate goes up, but not as high. You have a longer time to wait before you start seeing capacity developed in your debt service under the plateau.
What is the difference between the two? How do we go from the one financial recommendation to the other? Are we still buying the same buildings? Are we still building the same buildings?
All three of them assume everything that we started with, which is we're continuing to roll over the current ban. We're going to getting the new borrowing for what's already been authorized. That's the 190 plus the 695 plus everything passes in the capital at the fall town meeting, plus the two buildings that are on the fall town meeting, plus the library that would come online in 2 years. So all of that, all those same basics are considered for each of the scenario. The difference is only in how you finance it.
So explain that to me. What are we doing different?
What are we doing differently?
And if you want me to wait until the third scenario is done, so you can explain all three of them at once.
Right, because maybe you won't want to hear the first two after you got the third. Because I like the third.
Setting the hook, are we?
So the final one that we are recommending is called the flattest. And if you take one, pass it around, that would be great. Linda and I are recommending the flattest. I was originally going for staircase, but I ended up with the flattest.
Flattest as in most flat, F-L-A-T-T-E-S-T. I had a little trouble over the phone understanding what was being said on that one, so we're talking about the flattest tax.
And this one has the least tax impact. So if you look at the graph, you start at the 90 cents, and you go up to about $1.19. So you're less than a 20% increase in the tax rate based upon all of the borrowing for all of the articles, for all the buildings, plus the library. You have to wait a little longer before you start building in capacity within your debt service, but it's still there around 2024, 25. You're in a position to start thinking about a highway garage.
So we get back to your original tax rate around 18 years from now.
I would say that you're going around 2036.
That's original tax rate for borrowing only, right?
For, just for the borrowing, that's exactly right.
For the borrowing, because the other tax rate's growing at 2.5% a year.
Correct.
Okay.
And now you're seeing the difference between them, because it takes much longer to restore, if that's what the goal is, to be, that's because it's been flattened out, as opposed to the other ones where you're gonna spike up much higher in the earlier years, you're gonna get more of that principal paid off, and then it's going to drop back down again and get to the original place sooner. But actually, I think the flattest, this one makes more sense.
In the context of?
In the context of our current needs and our, what we know is in the pipeline for the next 10 to 20 years, up to 20 years, we can't pretend there's not, that we're done. We make all these borrowings and we're done. There's still going to be new equipment, new vehicles, and new buildings coming on. So we need to make some room in the future, but we don't necessarily need to make the room, as explained in the first two scenarios, by getting that out of the way quickly, and then we have that big drop. But the drop isn't as low as
I think we had this conversation a few times, too, because with the lease programs going on for the equipment, it may be better for the town to go with a lease purchase deal on some of this equipment, because at 20 years, you're already well into the replacement.
It's done.
Mm-hmm. Hadfield leases everything.
Yep.
A lot of towns and cities are doing that, and it seems to be working out pretty well. But then you're adding to the operating costs.
Linda, could you talk about the corresponding borrowing period and the related equipment, because we're not putting everything out over 20 years in this schedule, correct? So to John's point, like, buildings typically are...
The buildings will be out over 20 years.
Right, over 20.
They have to be out over 20 years. The only flexibility we have in borrowing for the buildings is how soon we borrow for them. I think that in the first year was about between $500,000 and $600,000 might be needed by the end of this year, assuming that they both pass. And everything has to be on the assumption everything's going to pass. Well, that's our starting point. Okay, so we'll be borrowing something to get going on them. I think there are the designs needed for the senior center, for example. That would be something that's going on right away. So that borrowing would happen in 17, but we'd be putting off borrowing the bulk of it. The rest of that, $7.1 million would be put off. We can put off some more of the impact of that by putting them initially into a BAN. BAN is BAN, which is a bond anticipation note. These are the one-year notes, such as the one we just took out this June. You can get the lower interest rate and perhaps bump that down the road, plus you don't have to pay off. You get a little more flexibility in what you're paying off in that first year, so you're going to pay off all of your interest, some of the principal. So again, you can flatten that a little bit more by just pushing that off, but once you get into the bond, the full bond, then you're set for 20 years what it's going to be. Another factor then is whether he has used 5% on the bonds.
Which is very high.
Which is high.
Today.
And, right now. And every economic predictor is indicating that rates will likely remain relatively low for a prolonged period of time. And in munis, municipal notes, they're looking at, we're likely going to be seeing this for another 5 to 7 years, that they'll be extremely attractive.
You feel a lot more comfortable using 5 than 2, right?
I think we're using five, absolutely.
So that's significant. That's more than doubling.
Okay.
And for the same reason of wanting some kind of control over it, I feel more comfortable with something that starts a bond within a couple of years, not necessarily year one, especially if we don't need all the amount. Why should we borrow money that we're not spending yet? But once we get into the heavy-duty spending, I would say we're going to look for the next opportunity to get into bonds so we can settle on an interest rate. But the other part of what you were asked about, within that, okay, so there are the equipment that we borrow are not necessarily, I would not want to see them go into a 20-year bond.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that John,
that gets
back to John's point. Yeah.
So that's one
reason.
Why
are we using them for 20 years?
Right. That's one reason for the drop-off in all of the scenarios is that those bonds, we use them longer than that. But
Well, before they used to last 30 or 40 years, but they don't anymore, so.
Yeah, not if we keep borrowing, I've actually forgotten where it was. That, yes, those, we're going to get some of those, we're going to keep the equipment in the ban mode so that we can, you know, get those paid off. I still really favor that we take those items that we, especially if individually they're less than 100,000 and their useful time is less than 5 years, I think that's a lot of energy and upfront cost. There are fees associated with bonds. If we can keep rolling those into bans and get them paid off, that we're better in the long run too. So those will get paid off in the earlier years, and that's why under every scenario it drops off.
David went through that a couple of times when he was here, I remember talking
about
it.
We already had lengthy discussion about leasing. Remember the backhoe? If we should borrow or lease, and the consensus after all that discussion was not to lease.
I think we should.
It wasn't
revisit
in our
it.
Best interest.
Yeah, I think it's fine to revisit that every time we get equipment. I think we've seen so
computer
many changes.
Equipment in particular.
Yeah. Because every time, at every decision point, we're going to, this, what direction you need to go, we want to go in now is one decision point. Every time a ban rolls over, or it's time to do a bond, we have another opportunity to make a decision again, or a new piece of equipment. We have a decision, we can decide then whether leasing or purchasing makes sense at that time. This gets us started, and we need to know what direction we're going in. And then we can work with our advisor and fine-tune it some more. You know, if, for example, you were all interested in one of the first two, we would go in one direction. If you're all also interested in the flatter rate of one, then I have, we have a few ideas still to talk about, and getting some examples of what if we do push this bond off a little bit longer than he says, what if we authorize some of this equipment. We never have to borrow the equipment immediately. We're still buying equipment that we have authorized 1, even sometimes 2 years previously. So we're not going to borrow on a ban. We're not going to put that financing into anything until we're ready to buy it.
So can we just hit the pause button for a second?
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I think, again, without jumping ahead and presuming the outcome of the special town meeting or rendering an opinion on the outcome of the special town meeting, so it seems like one of the questions for the tri-board is, if we find ourselves in a position to be borrowing, and if that borrowing involves long-term borrowing that includes some big-ticket items like buildings, from our standpoint, do we think it would be better to kind of mitigate the impact on the tax rate and on the taxpayer for a longer period of time, recognizing that it will take a longer amount of time for that debt to eventually come off the rolls? Or would we prefer to look at a scenario where perhaps there was some quote-unquote short-term pain, which may be significant, where the debt is front-end loaded over a 5 to 7 year period, but then it's freeing up larger? So, I mean, is that the general
It's
question?
The same thing any homeowner goes through when they're trying to decide whether they're going to do the 15, the 20, or the 30-year mortgage.
Right.
You know it's smarter to do the 15, but that's a lot more money. And you know when you do the 30, you're going to pay a bit more, a lot more in interest. But that makes it more manageable on the monthly basis when you're paying your mortgage and you still have tuitions ahead.
And when
so,
it's cheap money, I'd even argue the point. But yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But you know what we're a little different than your homeowner's mortgage mm-hmm. right now at this point. You still got the people on a fixed income, which we have more and more seniors coming onto the fixed income outlook here in town. You know, the flat, the lower amount, even though it'll cost us more in the end, will be a little bit easier on a pocketbook for everybody that's out there right now.
Yeah, let's talk about numbers then. Let's put some numbers to this.
What happened, you know, how many people in this room are going to be here 20 years from now to watch this debt go away? And
I'm going to be on a fixed income.
Okay,
you see where I'm coming from?
I hope you do.
Okay,
if it goes up $1.40,
yeah.
Right? That's about what, $400 on the average, the $317,000 house?
Is that what the number is?
About that. I did it roughly on my phone.
Actually, your.
There's a sheet.
There's a page right after, your second page of it shows the impact on the average household.
I just calculated it by.
Well, you can do that too.
1117 versus 1255.
That's why you're on the finance committee, Glenn.
Right. But that's, so we're looking at which sheet?
It's kind of difficult even to talk about.
So what do you think the threshold is that the people are gonna tolerate?
I don't think that's, and that's for town meeting to respond to that question, Mark.
Absolutely, but I mean, I'm asking you to speculate.
I just agreed with John. I think that given the climate we're in and given what we're trying to accomplish, to the extent we can accomplish a lot, again, at the will of town meeting vote, accomplish all of this and minimize the impact on the taxpayers, absolutely the way to go. Meaning using the flatter approach if we're going to borrow. Again, we're just talking about conceptually right now. We're not talking about the articles themselves. What, David?
I was just gonna do a sort of like a big picture discussion. So all the articles that are borrowing, all of the buildings, three of them, all the debt that we've already authorized, but we haven't incurred yet. It's gonna increase the tax rate 28 cents. You're still gonna have the lowest tax rate in the valley. And on the other side of the coin, you're looking at comparable costs for rehabbing the buildings rather than building new. So, you know, it's not a bad.
The problem doesn't go away.
Yeah, you're not in a bad situation.
Right, and if these are buildings that the town wants to have, then they're leaving these for the, that's a decision that people will get to make. These are buildings they wanna have. It's our job to show them how they can have them and what it will cost them. And it's not just a matter of an expense and a budget item that goes from year to year. There's a different way of, and there's a different way of evaluating a capital asset. And I think that that's something that Hadley's been really clear about for a long time. We are champions of debt exclusion overrides because we know when we wanna buy our items and we want them on the tax rate and off the tax rate. That's just the way we have voted in the past. So I think if we're very fair about what's being presented out there and what's going to go into that capital, that they can make those decisions.
Could do the other two. Reviewing.
Could do the other two.
Okay.
You got 400 on the staircase. What you got on the other two?
Yeah. What about the flat?
No, I just did the $140.
Good.
The flat $140
on
the 1115 is the existing tax rate.
Yeah.
Right. And if you add $1.40. That comes up to 1255 times the 317, the average cost of home, median cost of home.
Okay, so the plateau would be what?
Well, I raised it in my phone, but it was roughly $400.
That's on the staircase.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the steepest one. But then, Linda, do you have the figures for the plateau and the cost?
You know, I wrote down I can't walk through it the way Mark did, but I wrote down by the time we finished talking this through today, we were talking about $78.
Right.
It looks like
I have the answer, but not the
on
question.
On a flat one?
It looks like the flattest is around $1.18 instead of $1.40.
No, $1.08. The flat one is $1.18 relative to 90 cents.
Yes. Started 90.
Yeah. So it's 28.
Yeah.
Cents.
Oh, you're going the other way. You're
yeah, he's doing it
so
the other way.
20,
yeah.
28 cents would be the increase in the tax rate.
Look,
and what's
28
the
times 1,000 times the 317.
It's a little difficult to even analyze these three scenarios until the townspeople actually take their votes. And then we see what we spent and how much they voted for. Then we can go back and choose the option that best suits the taxpayer, I think. But my question, I guess, is the three scenarios, how are they covering the omnibus budget? Is that covered completely? Are we looking at the end of the fiscal year, taking another $500 for free cash to balance it like we've done the last 3 years? Or is it going to be fully funded, the omnibus budget?
And that's where that 362 came from for 16, right? That was the debt in the operating budget?
Yes, but it's on capital items. It's it's in the, ultimately, all of the debt and interest shows up in the operating budget, but I think Donald's talking about the rest of the operating budget.
I'm not worried about voting the articles.
Right.
That's the will of the people. But we have to have a balanced budget. That's our responsibility. And we haven't had a balanced budget in this town at least 5 or 6 years. We're always deferring the annual town meeting. Let's wait till, we'll leave $2.39 in free cash like last year. Let's hope it goes to 500,000 so we can use it to offset the following year's budget. If that doesn't happen, we're really in big trouble. We're either gonna take the money from stabilization to balance our budget, but the Department of Revenue says you do not use money you do not have. And that's what we've been doing for the last 6 years, using money for the omnibus budget that we do not have. And we've got to stop doing that.
So at the end of the annual town meeting, we entered into thinking that we had a shortfall of $124,000. At the end of the summer, with the new cheer sheet and better new growth figures than we had anticipated, that shortfall was reduced to $85,000. So we're going to be using $85,000 of free cash in order to balance the budget that was passed at the annual town meeting. Then there's the additional items for the omnibus budget that we had talked about, $75,000 for the schools, $48,000 for the police department, $251,000 for OPEB. So those are the other items that need to be funded through the omnibus budget, and I believe we have sufficient free cash to do that.
What about the hypothetical figures for like medical marijuana? We plugged in 50,000, 37,000 for UMass meal tax, which aren't coming about.
None of those numbers are in my my budget.
But when we left the annual town meeting, that's how they were in there. And that's how we were gonna balance with hypothetical situations.
Right,
but
so.
But they never came to fruition.
Well, the medical marijuana just passed.
So
we don't know, it could go to state level and they could not accept it. It's a hypothetical situation that we have the money in the bank.
It's not built yet, but.
So I have not included those numbers in the current budget projection for FY17.
So I guess my question to you is, these three scenarios will cover the omnibus budget and we will not have to take money from free cash for the following year to pay our bills?
We haven't done the budget yet.
Yeah, I haven't done the budget yet for FY18.
No, but 16, so I guess even looking at it, our regular increases, and we're not putting anything extra in this scenario with the increases to cover the budget? The shortfall that we have now?
Right, so
exactly.
you need 85.
No, let David walk through it again.
You have $85,000 that you need to fund the omnibus budget in order to bring it into balance based upon the votes that were taken at the annual town meeting.
And that's coming from taxation?
That would be coming from free cash.
Free cash?
Yeah.
Of last year, this year's free cash, or next following year?
This year's certified free cash.
Okay, and the rest of the money is going where?
So we $251,125 would go to the OPEB account, which will fully fund our target for OPEB for FY17. $75,000 back to the school, as we requested. $48,000 would go to the police department in order to fund the enhanced program that we had talked about with the chief of police. I'm proposing another $16,000 for cost of living adjustment of 1.5% for the non-union personnel, which is commensurate with what the union personnel got. And I believe you have enough free cash to cover all of that.
Okay, when after everything that you stated,
let's get back to this.
What does it leave in free cash?
That would leave $88,000 roughly in free cash.
Okay, thank you.
Just last week it was down to like $34,000.
We've been working with the accountant in order to come up with better free cash estimates. Obviously, you try to be conservative when you're not entirely sure.
I've been on this board for 4 years, and the first time I ran because of this, and we have not balanced the budget since I've been here. I got to agree with Donald. We go through this every single year.
So that thought process, I think, should come into play when we're actually making a recommendation on the individual articles.
I made them.
No,
and
I mean,
you three voted to just keep taxing and spending. That's what we're doing.
But I think what we're talking about right now is just a hypothetical. And so I think Linda and David are bringing this to us to say one of the questions that's going to come up when we go to the forum is going to be, how on earth are we going to pay for all of this?
Yeah.
And we need to be able to explain, if it's the will of the taxpayer, how we might go about paying for this. I think that's what we're trying to talk about right now,
mm-hmm.
right? Mm-hmm. But certainly the point that Donald's making, that you're making, I'm sure that's going to be a discussion point
yeah.
when we vote on these articles ourselves this evening.
You know, I mean, there's some hard numbers for the people to look at now. You know, they know
exactly.
what their tax rate is.
It won't be if we get to them.
That's on capital only. And.
Yeah. I know, but
I
go on to vote for $10 million worth of buildings, I want to know what it's going to cost me. So now we've got some numbers to tell
right.
the people this is what we're looking at.
Right.
You know, depending on how we borrow it.
Was that your happy voice or your sad voice? I couldn't tell.
Yeah.
Plus the interest.
But you will see, and I'm just a little concerned about something you said earlier, you will see the interest payments on this
yeah.
in the operating budget.
Yes.
All right. But that portion of the operating budget is funded by the debt exclusion override.
Yes.
Okay, all right, okay. Just wasn't sure that was clear.
So when does Milo get his building?
Pardon?
When does Milo get his building?
Does it
We're going to create a
17 years from now?
2080, 2060, somewhere around there.
Or when the taxpayers want to vote for it.
When the taxpayers want to
vote. Get out of the bigger shovel.
Mm-hmm. So actually that's something, could we just, so we talked about what's in here. So again, what's in here is the proposed North Hadley substation, the senior center, the proposed library, and then all of the proposed borrowing articles related to equipment that are in the special town meeting warrant. What is not included in here are, you know, other capital plan large ticket items that we're aware of, but they haven't been. So it's the
DPW building. The main fire station.
The modifications to central station that were recommended by the building committee.
And generally equipment and vehicles.
Right.
Equipment and vehicles, is that? Yeah, mm-hmm. The thing. Right.
And one of these days we have
small
to deal items. With across the school.
And okay, there's a fourth.
Right. So those are not included in the numbers that you're looking at.
We're changing the
right.
family.
Right. Yeah. And this is the highest that it could be. Again, our highest interest rate. Also, we are hearing some, at least one of the building committees talking about maybe that will come down. Maybe some individual items will come down. Maybe they'll get put off. So this is the highest point.
Yeah, it's the most conservative figure
it is the, yes.
based on the information.
Now, is that figuring in the library's grant?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's making an assumption. It's using the library, the town's share of the library at $2.9 million. So it's the town's share that's being financed. It's not being adjusted for any capital fundraising that they're able to do over the next couple of years, which would bring that number down.
And there's no running over budget.
There's no running over budget.
Over budget for like the library.
We're not actually voting on the library right now either.
Mm-hmm.
So.
We're
voting on their yeah. right. They're being filing an application in,
for the
in
grant.
It. But for these purposes, we again made the assumption, fair to all, that everything is passing and the library would come online, I believe, in 2 years, and that's why it doesn't go down. You know, that's why it stays flat. Yes.
State was just in here a couple weeks ago, and we're not taking probably $2 million into consideration for water and sewer from the center of town to south of North Maple Street, because we're planning that whole project too.
Mm-hmm.
So that's going to be a capital borrow.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That would be paid through the enterprise fund, not the...
Yeah, but it's still going to be a capital borrow.
Of course it would.
But it's not part of...
Not
this
part of that, because this is a general fund.
Right.
Still comes from the same pocket.
It could be.
So Molly, what we're looking for tonight, I know your forum is in one more week. We told David Eisenthal, stop, because he, you know, he had 16 scenarios to come up with these three. And stop working, let's see which direction the board wants to go in, and then the rest of the efforts can go into doing a bit more on this. We can do, we can work on the presentation of it, put some explanation in it, as you had suggested earlier. We can work on that if we are just given the general, yes, go in that direction, and then, as we listen to your recommendations, on these capital items later on, perhaps, you know, there might be some adjustments, or if there are any items being pulled out by any department, that would be adjusted down, and that would help us a bit more too in coming up with something more accurate so that we can answer the questions better next week.
Are you in essence asking us to vote on one of the three scenarios?
Yes.
Thank you.
You got it.
Mark, do you have a feeling on that as to, you know, you asked us... You asked us our feelings as to how, what we thought the palatability of the citizens would be.
Yep.
John certainly is indicating that he thinks that the flatter rate, while it might cost a little more, in the long run, it's easier to digest today.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about half of the 400, I think, is what it turns out to be.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be about a $200 increase per year to get all this wish list taken care of.
It might be a question to pose our assessors when they start, or collectors, when they start to get complaints.
The day the bill goes out is the answer to that. We have the lowest tax rate and we get the same complaints as every other town there is.
Yeah, I think I actually came up with a lower number. I think it's about a 2.5% increase. So whatever your tax bill is, it would go up by about 2.5%, I think.
I mean, I'm just going to come right out and say it while I'm looking at this lower amount. Because maybe it'll stop some of the bickering between the library, between the senior center, between the fire station, and then we can come to some kind of conclusion here and move forward. We've got a lot of major building problems here that we've ignored for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to move on quite a few of these, unfortunately.
As a segue, I mean, wouldn't it be smart if we're going to do the library and the Council on Aging to use the same architect, the same general contractor, the same site subcontractor, et cetera?
I don't know what kind of stipulations they're going to put on that library because of funding.
Library grant funding is very specific.
Because of the grant. Mm-hmm. You know, I just went through that grant thing over there with USDA. And, you know, they have so many restrictions and qualifications and on and on and on for grants.
But to me, it would still, if you've got it dug up right there, it would still make sense to use the same contractors, the same site plan, and the same site work, et cetera, you know, the same brick.
I think Suzanne wanted to.
I'd like to speak to one aspect of that is the Council on Aging aspect of things is, I understand what you're talking about insofar as construction costs, contractors, and all the rest of that. Where I disagree to some extent, although it's early, because we haven't had the pleasure of actually meeting with a designer, is that we're finding some, you know, major differences in the cost between similar sized buildings. And we're not looking to be, we're looking to keep costs lower. And so I'm not sure if hypothetically the library's designer would be the designer we would want.
Mm-hmm.
So just keeping those things in mind, we're happy to work with whatever would be preferable to keep costs down insofar as the actual building process and things like that. But design-wise, I'm not so sure that's an easy transfer.
I wasn't referring to design.
Okay.
More construction costs.
Okay.
You know, if you've already got the guys there, you've got the equipment there, it makes a lot more sense to just go on to the next building, regardless of who designed it or what the design aspects are.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got the land torn up once, you know, rather than getting one building a third of the way done, now you're bringing in a whole nother set of equipment, except, you know.
We're getting into implementation though now.
That'd be kind of difficult to do because we have to put out bids and it always goes to the lowest bidder, so you can't make it inclusive.
So do you want us to take a vote, Linda?
Do we need a vote or a direction?
I think it would be.
We want to know what to present next week.
I'd like some more discussion on it. I think Mr. Waskevich has a good point. We have a very high elderly citizen population in this town, which can't take a big hit on the taxes. We have a lot of single family homes in this community. And the biggest question I have is our business sector. They're really suffering now with online purchases. A lot of our department stores are starting to, you know, look like they're going to close. If we lose our business sector, there goes our tax rate. That's how we survived in this town for 250 years, the business corridor. And so that's a big thing. I would like to spread it out, maybe consider more years as you spoke, from 20 to maybe 30. I don't know. We'll have to talk about that at another time to lessen the impact.
So you're in favor of that flattening scenario?
The flat one, yes, yep. At this point. And I think it'll be dictated by what gets passed at the fall town meeting.
Yep. Jerry?
I as well.
Okay. So I think it's unanimous from our standpoint.
Okay.
That would be our preference.
Then we'll work on presentation for next week.
Okay.
So that
book
work what?
Right. Book.
That you said?
Yes.
That
work. Thank you. Thank you for all the work that went into that. Okay, so just wrapping up the tri-board then, we're going to be talking about warrant articles tonight. Schedule-wise, when are you planning on meeting as a finance committee and doing your votes?
We got a posted meeting today. We only have two members. We don't not have a
Terry's.
Oh, Terry's here. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
We do have three members.
Okay.
Right. But
oh,
we
so
haven't
you're
discussed
meeting
them amongst ourselves. It'd be, I don't want to voice a vote at this time.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah, no, that's fine. I was just
do you
making
wanted,
sure. Okay.
Do you want to use my office to have your meeting to go over the warrant articles?
Okay.
Well, we're going over them again immediately anyways, within 10 minutes, right?
Yep.
All of them. So if you wanted to hear everybody's suggestions on them.
Okay.
Well.
Thanks. Don't avoid
another meeting.
Sorry. It was suggested. No.
Okay. All right, so do we have a motion to adjourn tri-board?
So moved.
All right, second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 All right, thank you. All right, with that, we'll move into the regularly scheduled October 12th Select Board meeting. And first, we will open with our consent agenda. So it looks like we have two items in the consent agenda. Is that correct?
Yes, there are two items on the consent agenda.
Okay, so it's point three, the
warrants. There's warrants, a change on a one-day liquor, and a shade tree appointment.
Oh, sorry.
I think you got to scroll a little bit.
Actually, I scrolled down too far.
No.
Okay. So we do not have minutes this evening.
Correct.
Not,
I apologize.
Okay. No, it's no problem. So for warrants, for payroll warrants, we have 1702S, 1704S, 1707, 1708S, 1708, and 1706. For accounts payable warrants, we have 1714, 1714-2, 1714S, 1715, 16, and 16S. Oh, not there yet.
Oh, yeah.
Then we have the request for she came in all fired up. One-day liquor license change request. This is the top of the campus. They just want to change the hours. We already approved this license for October 29th, and they want to change the hours of that. And then we also have...
what were your original hours?
Original hours are 11 to 6. Or 11 to 5, excuse me, they want to change it from 10 to 6 because the football, the...
It says 10 to 5.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to turn the name. Sorry, from 10 to 5, and it was originally 11 to 6.
Okay.
And they want to change it because the, I don't think football department, the correct term, athletics department, has changed the kickoff several times, so they would like to just cover a broad span in case it's changed again.
Okay. And then Terry Yushko has volunteered to be on the shade tree, and that is an appointment request. Okay. So do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, with that, we have public comment period, if there's anyone here for public comment. John?
Yeah, I stopped and talked to Tim Nyhart about this, Steve Lewis dealership. I've noticed he's parked quite a few cars on the Five Sisters parking lot. Mm-hmm. In the site plan review, all his vehicles are supposed to be set on his property. And I want to know why he expanded his dealership on other properties that he don't even have a permit to. Mm-hmm. And what's going to prevent other people from doing the same thing. It's class two license holders, mm-hmm. and you got another dealership. I think that is, I don't know if this board ever granted permission for that, but I don't know how they can to allow someone to use two lots for one dealership.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's public comment, so we'll take that under advisement and we will get a response to you.
Yeah. Okay. Just to respond briefly, we're aware of the complaint.
Mm-hmm.
Part of it is a zoning issue, which is not for the select board. The other part is the administration of the class two license, and we're doing some research on that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep. Okay.
Doesn't Country Nissan actually have storage over there, don't they? One lot storage, one lot sales, or something like that?
Right, so we're looking into the history of Country Nissan as well as Steve Lewis Subaru. Whatever we did consistently for one, we should do for the other.
Okay. Just in the spirit of time management, we have two other items. One is the town administrator's report, and the other one is special town meeting to review the warrant articles. Just to try to protect the interest of making sure we make it through, let's just start with the warrant articles.
My administrator's report is all town meeting all the time.
Good answer.
All right.
I like that.
All right, so do you want to kick off our discussion here, David?
All right, so I've given you two handouts, one of which is the most recent version of the law that I sent off for legal review. It's been reviewed by bond counsel and partially reviewed by Koppelman and Page. I will try to catch up with town counsel on this. He did provide some comments to about four of the articles. I'm still waiting on the others. The other is the division of motions.
Mm-hmm.
So we typically divide up the speaking responsibilities. So article one, number one is the omnibus budget adjustment. Most of this is a planned adjustment consisting of program extensions, restoration of money to the schools, funding the OPEB, 1.5% COLA for the non-union personnel. There's a reduction in the health insurance. We had it budgeted at $1,225,000, given that the rates were far lower than we had estimated than they were, and given that we had a surplus in that account for FY16, I'm recommending a $25,000 reduction in that program. We have a revenue neutral adjustment in debt and interest, and as I said, it would take about $85,000 to balance this budget, plus an additional $251,125 for the OPEB, $75,000 for the schools, about $16,000 and change for the COLA, and about $48,000 for the enhanced program for the police department. If we do that, we have about $88,000 left in free cash for capital projects.
Okay. Is that so? What we're looking at, David, on Article One, mm-hmm. these are all of the requests carry forward from the annual town meeting.
Right.
So when I'm listening to you, I'm not hearing all of these. So you didn't mention the expanded fire program?
Correct. That's going to be covered by the SAFER grant, so that goes away.
Okay, so could you run down this list so we know what's still in and out and the numbers that you're talking about?
Absolutely.
Is that what we're doing? We're doing the town warrant now?
Yes.
Yes. I'm sorry, Joyce, welcome to the...
Yeah, thanks for stopping.
Well, and if there's any doubt, Joyce, as you can see...
People do have real jobs, Jen.
Came from work.
Just slightly.
Whoa, that's pretty wild, right?
So let's pass over that.
I appreciate you.
Keep chirping.
He shuts down his real job, we all got trouble.
Oh, exactly.
I'm hot tonight.
Okay, so... Just very quickly, if we start at assessor's expense, $6,066, I'm recommending a lower amount because the program expansion, I'd never recommended that expansion. I'm only recommending $1,250 of that particular expansion.
And have you discussed that with Dan Zadonik?
Yes, I have.
Okay.
The other one is the $108,550 for the police, fire department. We're taking that away because we don't need that under the SAFER grant.
Did we get the SAFER grant?
We didn't get it, but the fire chief has requested that we withdraw that.
Did we not get it, or are we waiting?
We're waiting.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. We weren't denied, we're just waiting.
We were not denied.
The 108?
That's 108, so that's not on the table anymore.
Okay.
The next one would be 422, the highway construction salary. And let me just double check my notes. There's a program expansion of $18,850 that's requested. I'm recommending, with Marlo's consent, only $13,600 of that. Education gets restored at $75,000.
I'm having problems following this. I mean, I hear the numbers you're saying, but it doesn't coincide with anything that we're... The restored, I see the number, but I see a number on just for assessors of 6066.
Yeah, you changed that to 1,250.
You just changed that, yes.
Okay, so it's not... It's wrong here. It needs to go... Okay, that's what we're doing.
And then the 18850 was changed to 13,6. Now we're on the second page.
Okay, so the Park and Rec expanded programs, we talked about that last time. They had requested a sizable increase in their program for renting out space, and I'm recommending only $6,386 for that, which would be the expanded hours for the director.
And not for rental?
Not for rental.
So can you repeat that again? Not the 42,000.
Not the 42,386,
right.
But...
So it's the 6,000 for?
6,386 would be for the expanded hours for the director.
And so what will her hours go up to?
Should be 25 hours.
And what were the justification for the expanded hours? I'm sorry, I'm just forgetting. I remember Kathy talking about it, but...
Right.
What was the need?
She's 25 hours now, isn't she?
She is 25 hours now, is it?
Yeah.
So
what is she going to?
30.
That would be up to 30.
What's the recommendation again?
$6,386.
$6,386.
So is that going to be a rental requirement?
We talked about that for quite some time. We found office space at the senior center for the administrative offices of the Park and Rec Commission. So what do they need? They need a couple of desks, they need a telephone, a couple of computers, they need lighting, they need four walls and a ceiling and a floor. And we could provide that for them. Their programming is held off-site anyways. The only thing that we're still looking for is the Zumba, and we're still working on that issue. So there's no need for us to rent $40,000 worth of space for their programming or for their operations.
How about storage for their equipment?
We got plenty of that over.
Okay.
We got lots of basement space over at the Russell School that's not being used. Yeah.
So is the North Hadley Hall, are they continuing to use that for their programs until it's decided that town hall, I mean, town meeting, what's going to happen with it?
I think their last program is tomorrow.
Tomorrow, the last Simba class then.
Remember, we only funded half a year's of operation out of that building, so come December 31st, theoretically, we don't have any money for heat or power or lighting or toilet or anything like that. So the building will be mothballed at that point if it's not been sold.
She explained this morning that the last program is Zumba, and it's tomorrow night, and then they're looking for a new home for it. And she hasn't come up with one yet.
They said that last week at our meeting.
Is there any money to mothball that?
Well, again, theoretically, it's going to be sold.
But if it isn't, there's water in it, that's going to be dewatered.
I have a maintenance account for that that building under the budget number 490 that would cover that, those costs. But again, the intention of the town is to sell the building.
So, David, do we need to, I mean, I know, you know, the conversation we had about this at the last meeting, but since then, Tim Neihardt went through to see if there was any possibility of them utilizing the upstairs of the Hooker School.
Right.
Are there any costs associated with that that need to be taken into account here?
Yes, there would be additional costs there. We do have money available for that.
We do, okay.
Both in the maintenance account for the senior center, as well as if you wanted to repurpose money in the two articles that cover town hall and the senior center. There's about $50,000 that could be used for the senior center if we need to. Okay.
And then the expanded hours for the director. So if it's on here, we must have approved this as a carry forward from the spring, although I'm not remembering. Do you remember discussion about expanding the hours?
My memory on this one is a little hazy. I can double check this.
She kind of explained it because different programs are in different places now. She's doing a lot more running around.
Okay.
Along with a few more hours that she's putting in wherever she's going to move to.
Yeah, I mean, I know how hard she works. I'm just questioning, that's a pretty significant increase, and then it has would have benefit impacts as well. And
because they moved a lot of them to the school, right?
Yeah.
Correct? That's what I heard.
The programs were always at the school. I mean,
Some other ones that she had up there, though, I believe.
She had summer art and craft camp.
Yeah.
That was
she went through a whole list of them.
I have no idea. You would have to ask her, but that's not mine.
Okay. So sorry, that's the only one I'm just questioning. I don't remember that we agreed to the expanded hours.
Okay. My only question is, now we reduced probably close to 150K. Where did it go from here? Where did you plug it in?
No, it was just taken out.
But it had to go somewhere. It was initially part of the budget.
Well, we're getting there.
Well, that's what I'm asking. Where did it go?
Well, we're going down all the rest of them here.
Right.
There's other things that are on here.
Right. So
it had to go somewhere to offset something else.
Yeah, so I think that it's not repositioned. It's avoided cost.
Right.
That we're simply not funding.
We're not spending
We're not deploying the dollars elsewhere. We are not funding that.
So it should lessen the burden on the omnibus budget.
It's 25.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. And then you already talked about the 25 reduction in health coverage, and then
that's all in that $362,000. Where it's at right now.
Waiting for the final.
Okay.
So 80. What were your numbers again? So.
Me while I find the right piece of paper.
Yeah.
All right, so we had a shortfall of $85,818, which we have to make up with free cash. The COLA would be another $16,015. The recommended expanded programs and other adjustments would be $48,354. restoring the school at $75,000, and funding the OPEB at $251,125. And again, that's the target number for OPEB.
Okay, so we'd be voting tonight on whether or not we want to move forward with these items as you have adjusted.
Right.
And is there a way between now and the actual town meeting to get clarity on the park and rec issue?
Sure, we can do that.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So are people comfortable voting, holding that? Well, I mean, I'm just asking to have that held aside. I don't feel like we have enough information on that one. If everybody else agrees or not. Okay, so are people comfortable voting on everything other than that one increase?
Do.
No? You say yes?
I do.
Oh, okay.
Oh, do.
Okay. I do.
Okay, does anyone want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to accept the omnibus budget as presented with the changes.
Second.
Except for
The parking lot. Okay, and Jerry seconded. Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Did you abstain or?
I don't know.
I don't know.
Still thinking about it.
Do you want to talk more?
You know, no, I'm just, all right, I'll think out loud. This was pushed out from the annual town meeting, all the expanded versions.
Mm-hmm.
And we came across a few of them, fire and council and park and rec,
mm-hmm.
that we have cut. But
yep.
All this is going into next year's budget again.
That's right.
And we still aren't balanced this year, and doesn't look like we're going to be balanced next year either.
Mm-hmm. I'm inclined to agree with you, John. I'm not happy voting for this, but
yeah.
I'm voting for this because we have to. We have to have the money to pay for 217, so.
For the clarity of the record, what is the vote?
Yes. We'll put it on. Let the people vote it down at town meeting if they feel the same way I do.
5-0.
Yep, 5-0.
Article 2 is the HPAC transfer. This is on the consent agenda. We're proposing that it's beyond the consent agenda. It's simply housekeeping to sweep up the last of the HPAT money from the gift account over to the enterprise fund that we had created at the annual town meeting.
Okay.
No
so.
Impact upon taxes.
Okay. Originally it was $60,000, right? Now we're taking $20,000 out of it.
Yeah,
in the process.
I originally had a figure that was around $90,000. Mr. Truswell has made some purchases for capital, so it's reduced the amount that's going to be transferred. So we received a payment from Charter Communications on June 14th of $69,000. So that's the bulk of the money that you see there.
I make a motion to accept it.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No.
Do you want to explain why, Donald? Or?
Well, because we're taking another $20,000 out of there as we're doing for sewer and water from the enterprise fund to fund something, but I don't know what.
So there is a reserve account?
There's $40,000 that we're funding, and we're taking another $20,000 from that account. $10,000 from the sewer, $10,000 from the water,
right.
And $20,000 from the...
So this is a recommendation of the Department of Revenue when they reviewed our finances back in 2013, that in the enterprise fund, just as we have in the general fund, we have a reserve account that for unanticipated and unforeseen expenses. In the enterprise funds, we didn't have anything like that. So on the recommendation, we've created $10,000 reserve funds for water and sewer. And in the horse trading that went on at the annual town meeting, we did a $20,000 reserve fund for HPAT. To spend out of that requires a vote of the finance committee, same as with the general fund, reserve fund. So it's like a mini reserve fund, but having within each of the enterprise funds. I think that's what you're
referred to.
Yeah, my only worry is, say if the building gets torn down by the people, we have to find a new home for HPAC, and it's gonna be very costly to relocate, get him somewhere else, bringing all the cables in, new equipment and everything. And if we keep chipping away at the money that we have there for other things, we're not gonna have the money for HPAC television to find a new home.
But that's not also gonna happen right away either. I mean, the process is just starting. If that does pass about the senior center, then we still have time. It's not gonna be something that's gonna be overnight. And we do get a yearly payment from Charter, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so 410.
So Article 3, again, we're recommending this as a consent agenda. It does require a two-thirds majority vote. We're taking up a lot of old balances that are lying around on being unproductive, and we're returning them to the fund from which they came. So some of these are small, a little less than $20. Some of them are larger, $24,000. But the main point is that the project for which the original appropriation was made are now complete. And the money is, whatever surplus money is sitting around and is being unproductive. Let's return it to the original fund from which it came in compliance with Department of Revenue requirements and make it available for other purposes. The other part of this is the excess borrowing. Again, we had a project, we completed the project for which we borrowed money. We didn't need the entire amount. We have very small amounts left on the books, and it still has to be reported annually to the Department of Revenue. Let's clean that up and take care of that so that we have less clutter to pester Department of Revenue with, and we have the opportunity to add capacity to our debt.
Motion to accept.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any other question?
John?
You got here sewer Louisiana Lane sewer reserve, sewer pump station, $9,000 sewer impact. Is any other thing that's in the DPW, such as a DPW John Deere loader? Was a portion of money ever taken out of a sewer reserve or sewer impact fee for that? And the DPW backhoe, the DPW tractor, DPW loader.
Here, yeah.
It's right there on the back.
We didn't even bring up that article yet, did we?
No. So the answer is that wherever the money came from, if you're going to return it, it has to go back to the same pocket. So we've not been able to identify any mixed-use money for a capital purchase that we would then have to return to an enterprise fund or to the general fund.
Well, why I ask that, because on the Springtown meeting, there was a combination of different sources of money for articles, and I just want to make sure if that hasn't happened again, or was this included in those articles, because it was.
Okay. Well, I'm very certain that this article complies with the Department of Revenue regulations that dictate that where the money came from, if you're going to return it, it has to go back to that same pocket. I can't take free cash money and transfer that over to the sewer department.
I understand that. I'm just making sure it wasn't shortchanged.
Mm-hmm. These borrowings were all general fund.
Okay.
They weren't out of the enterprise fund or being paid from the enterprise, the borrowing section.
But the money did come from sewer reserves and sewer impact here.
No,
for
not the borrowing items.
Right.
No.
Yeah, that's why it's in a different section. This is just borrowing, which was general.
And the final figure on Lorana Lane reflects the money that was taken out to finish the job there.
Yes, and
okay.
Also pump
right.
Stations 1 and 4 has
both.
Some set aside.
Okay.
But just to clarify with John, all these numbers are going back into exactly where it came from at the last column there. That's where they came from. When I worked through the spreadsheet, that's where they're going back.
Okay, Article 4.
Article 4, this is one of the Municipal Modernization Act opportunities. We talked a lot about this in a prior select board meeting. This is an opportunity to, for us to reduce our bond costs if there's a bond premium that's issued on a bid for a bond. And this particular article allows us to retroactively apply any bond premium to debt that's been authorized in the fall town meeting and the annual town meeting of last year, so that we can reduce the cost for borrowing. This appears to be a no-brainer. I thought about adding it to the consent agenda, but it's sufficiently complex that we probably want to talk a little bit about it.
So moved.
Second. Okay, no second, Donald. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You got a copy of the chapter and section of law you pertain to? Or?
Yeah, I can provide that for you.
What was John's rule?
Five.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, Article 5.
Article 5 is the first of the major capital articles. I've broken Article 5 into 7 motions. The first motion would be for the cash. So we have all the cash items. So the HPAT, the library, the unidirectional flushing, the prolonged pumping, the water valve mapping, the information technology, locker room upgrades, the security door upgrade, the fuel pump upgrade, sewer line assessment for Route 9, sewer manhole mapping, and clarifier upgrades, and then the Callahan water well filtration replacement project. All of these can be handled by cash, and we have sufficient, we think, to cover all of this. And so my purpose in combining this as one motion would be, since we have a lot of capital articles here, we could be there all night. So if we can handle this in 7 motions rather than a couple of dozen, I think people would appreciate that.
How's this being funded?
Reserves.
The borrowing or cash. Water reserves,
so HPAT would come from HPAT money. The technology for Goodland Memorial Library would come from capital stabilization funds. Water reserves would handle the unidirectional flushing and the prolonged pumping at the Mount Warner wells, and the water valve mapping. From capital stabilization, they would handle the information technology for the server downstairs for the locker room and the security group door of the public safety complex and the fuel pump upgrade from DPW. Sewer reserves would handle the sewer line assessment, sewer manhole mapping, and the sewer impact fee would finish off our project with the clarifier, keeping in mind that we have already appropriated $205,000 for the clarifier project. And then $52,000 from water reserves plus $101,000 from the Callahan well water filtration replacement reserve for the replacement of the water filtration units of the water division. Keeping in mind that for 10 years we've been putting money away for this project.
Do we have the current balances of the reserve accounts going into this article?
Sure.
So are you asking us to take separate votes on this, like the cash and the borrowing, separate them? The cash and the reserves together, make a motion for that, and then the borrowing, we can make a separate vote?
I just presented it like this because I wasn't sure how you wanted to handle it. I figured that people would appreciate going through this quickly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it's up to you as to how you want to handle that. So our sewer reserves is $592,425. Water reserves is $789,273.
And then capital stabilization?
Capital stabilization. Assuming that we have a article that passes before that, we would have capital stabilization balance right now is $8,349, and then you'd be transferring into that $7,427,000.
Where's that coming from?
Transferring to what?
7427.
Where'd that come from, David?
That came from the prior article where you're doing all those transfers.
Oh, the fund balance transfer.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. So the 3,000, 2,000 and change.
What was the first one? Water?
Water is 789,273.
Mm-hmm. Oh, what was sewer?
592,425. Okay, so the only thing here coming out of stabilization.
Goodwin.
Is the library, which is 10,000, which is more than the capital stabilization balance.
Which I wouldn't be interested in funding until after we understand whether or not where the town wants to go with the library. I mean, why would we fund that there?
Yeah, but we don't even want to present something to them where we don't have the money. Am I wrong?
I'm sorry, you have money for that. You have $91,000 of capital stabilization requests, and you'll have about $104,000 worth of free cash and capital stabilization to handle this.
Is that money well spent if the library is getting rebuilt in 2 years?
This would be for computer technology that could be transported.
Just transportable.
Okay.
You need separate motions?
Not for me.
Huh?
Not for me.
I don't mean to be dense here, but you're projecting that we have money from free cash to move into capital stabilization?
Right, so this is another thing that we can do. We can add a transfer of free cash into capital stabilization in order to bring the balance up even more. Or we can change some of the capital stabilization expenditures into free cash expenditures.
You're just saying you're taking it out of order.
I got it. Because I was just putting down that it was coming from capital stabilization. It's actually coming from free cash.
Yeah.
Okay. That was the confusion. I'm good now.
Into stabilization.
I'm not clear on that one. In the old rules, yes. Under the Municipal Modernization Act, the answer is that a transfer into stabilization is a simple majority. I'm not sure if the law has taken effect yet. I think the effective date is November 9th, so I would treat it as a two-thirds majority transfer into.
And out of.
And out of, yes.
I'd like to make a motion to vote on all seven separately. If I'm outvoted, I'll go with the board, but I would like to make that motion. Maybe there's no second, but I don't know.
How about if we do it this way? Is there anybody that's inclined not to vote for a particular line item, and then maybe we can just narrow that field in?
Take the individual one out, Donald, and put.
Well, I am when it comes to borrowing. There's a lot of things we're borrowing, and it's all inclusive, and many things in the highway department I question, do we need them or not? The dike, do we need that now, or can we save some money and, you know, delay it maybe for next year? I don't know.
Okay,
that's
so
the discussion
do you
want to
go through the borrowing articles? We can go through the borrowing one by one. Is there anybody else that's disinclined from any of the other line items we should review?
No, I think the cash that are coming out of reserves are fine together. But,
yeah.
You know, I got to agree with Donald. I think that people are going to want to vote on the needs are one thing, but the borrowing for capital that are really the wish list thing should be separate.
Okay, so let's go through each borrowing article, but just before we do that, does anybody have any questions on any of the sewer reserve or water reserve
What's the bottom line here? Before we get into all this, with all of these borrowings,
mm-hmm. Yes, the totals.
What's the total and how much is it going to cost us to borrow? Because
$2,038,000.
$2,038,000?
Yeah, for everything. And that was, how much did you say?
Well, keep in mind, all of this borrowing is reflected in the three scenarios that we showed to you during the tri-board.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
And what was the rate of that? It was pennies.
A band rate? Band rate's like 0.7. 0.4 to 0.7.
Well, What's the cost to the taxpayer?
For
the $2,038,000.
How much is that gonna be on the tax dollar?
I know $3 million, roughly $200,000.
So we had a long conversation about this, and we're looking at a 28-cent increase.
That's including the buildings.
Including the buildings.
28 cents?
Per thousand.
Per thousand.
Oh.
Oh, whoa, whoops, Santa Claus came early here.
We'll take 11.15, add the 28. And if you wanna see what it comes to the average homeowner, right? It's 317,000 is the average median home.
Yeah.
Right, and you can punch that out, divide by 1,000, you'll have it.
So it's like $88, right?
Yeah.
$88 over a 20-year period?
About 80 each year. Somewhere between $80 and $100.
You know, my real problem is we're voting on this, and we should have had the recommendations of the Finance Committee and the Capital Committee given to us prior to us making these recommendations. That's how the process works. They do their homework, get it to us, we analyze it and make our votes. We're putting the cart before the horse the way that we're doing it tonight.
Jerry, what's the status of the capital planning?
Monday.
Meeting Monday?
You can postpone the vote until after you hear from the Finance Committee.
I would, like, on all this borrowing money and buildings and things of that nature. It would make a lot more sense, but will we have time to get it in for posting and everything?
I have to post tomorrow, but you can post with a recommendation pending and make the recommendation from the floor.
Well, we need these theoretical numbers to explain this to the people at the forum. So if we don't have that, we're just wasting time at the forum.
Well, I guess we got some numbers. I mean, I'm sorry I wasn't here earlier, but if you're talking between $80 and $100 for all of the projects,
for an average.
That's just that.
And that's no weather. That's not what's going to happen next year.
Is that just this year, right here in front of us?
Plus the three buildings.
Plus the buildings. All of the borrowing articles.
All the borrowing articles.
Yes.
Okay.
No, it goes down. That's not it. It's not 80.
17 years. Yeah.
Okay. And we'll want Dan Zadonik. I mean, it's always good to have Dan double check everything.
Yep. We did do that. We had Mr. Zadonik talk to Mr. Eisenhall, so the recommendations are
tax rate.
It's good to have the whole financial team. Okay, so is it the pleasure for us to not discuss these tonight? Or do we want to?
I'd like to continue discussion just so we understand going forward with them and all.
So I'm going to move on to the motion number two, the MS4 permit. That's $390,000. This is the unfunded mandate that applies to the town of Hadley that we've been talking about for a long time and which has finally arrived. We have to accomplish compliance by next September. So that seems like a long time, but it really isn't. $390,000 would cover our compliance effort for the 5-year period of the permit, so we really need to do this.
I would recommend supporting motion two.
I'll second that motion. Okay. If we don't comply with this, we face $16,000 a day fine. So I certainly don't want to look at that down the road.
All in favor of approving motion two?
Aye.
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 Upstate.
Okay. Three, David?
Okay, number three, again, I just bundled all the equipment together. When I say the equipment, this is the anything with a wheel. So the two cruisers, the chipper, the skid steer, the staff vehicle, the light truck. And that comes up to $275,000. And it's all for the police department and Department of Public Works.
I guess that's what I was referring to. I want the finance committee and capital to have a stab at it before we do. Because there's all borrowing.
Duly noted.
Okay. Same with motion five?
Number four would be the school computers.
I'm sorry.
Okay, so this would be for the IT upgrades that they talked about for both the Hopkins Academy and the elementary school.
That number can modify?
It can come down a little bit. There's a bare bones budget, but you're just deferring the cost to another year.
Well, I heard 112 was the number I got.
Yeah, 112 can be the number there.
And on that, you know how we started an IT plan? Is there, so they're not part of our IT plan?
No, they have their own.
How much money do they have in school choice right now?
She told us that last week.
I don't have that figure off the top of my head.
The last meeting I attended, I think the figure was 750,000.
That sounds about right.
Don't hold me to it, though.
They started this, they started the fiscal year with 714,000.
Right, and then they have planned reduction on that, for a few hundred thousand, right?
And then they get, then we've had the incoming month too from the cherry sheet.
Sure, but I mean at the end of the year when they presented their budget, remember that they were planning on using a certain amount.
And I just printed this out the last week, and it's still at that figure, so I'm not sure if there was some...
Well, they would have voted it prior to the end of the fiscal year.
Right. I don't know. That's what's still showing up online on the accounting at 714 at the end of the year, but I understand.
Yeah, so, but I mean, any transfer they did should have been prior to the 714, so they would have voted like in May to move money from school choice into the regular budget, so it should all be cleared out.
It should have come out.
Yeah.
Was it about, you thought it was 200,000?
That's a couple hundred thousand. Yeah. And I mean, that's what was in this year's budget.
I don't
budget.
Have an itemized report. I just have the year-end figures.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Should an article like this be looked at by them?
Mm-hmm. Well, they met with... Didn't they meet with you guys?
We need this 140 figure. This is a more recent motion than our last meeting with them.
And it might be 112.
It might be 112. They said
they
could get away
with 112. The latest I got was 112.
Was that in her email?
But they're still requesting the 140, correct?
No, requesting 112. 112 is what I got.
Oh, okay.
An email.
David, can you clarify that with them?
I can clarify that with them.
Okay. But should some of that school choice money ever go to a project like this?
Well, you know, again, when they came in and they did their PowerPoint presentation and they showed how much they were requesting from the town, they were indicating that they were using a pretty significant portion of the school choice, but that they wanted to maintain a balance at a certain level, I want to say between 500,000 and 600,000, because of the possible sped swings and the like.
They wanted to call that their stabilization fund.
Right. So, I mean, I'm marching forward with the presumption that whatever they said was going to happen last year happened, and that they're proposing something similar this year. It's just you wouldn't see it come out of that 700 until the May of next year.
Initially, they were going to fund the athletic fields out of there, mm-hmm. but since then, they've gone to the CPA, and they're going to request the 500,000 from them now, mm-hmm. because it's put too much stress on their overall budget. The way they explained it to me, it's in 2019, their budget's going to implode. They're not going to have the money to fund everything. And so that's why they're trying to hold off on the school choice money to get them through 18.
Okay. So I'm going to move on to motion number five. It's for the school HVAC, 400,000. I think your caption there says public safety complex, but they've asked, public safety has asked that they be treated separately. Mm-hmm. So the HVAC for the school is $400,000. Motion number six, it's for the public safety complex HVAC, $45,000.
Motion number seven is for the dike survey, and again, this is for the subsurface evaluation of your dike.
Is that being required by an agency or something?
It's not being not being required right now by an agency, but that may come. The Army Corps of Engineers, ever since the flooding in the Mississippi River back in the Bush administration, has changed their criteria for maintenance and construction of dikes. They've been working their way up the Connecticut River. Their spar north is Chicopee, requiring cities and towns to change their dike design. They haven't come this far north. One of these days they will. I think this is just a good idea, considering that the dike was built right after the Civil War, and we don't know what its structural integrity is.
Well, we had decided when there was that break in the dike at the time that we had that problem that we were going to make sure we kept an eye on it and surveyed it at certain points, because we've had now, over the course of I don't know how many years, but there's been three that we've had to repair.
Three major sections
that we've had to take care of. So I mean, that's a long section to not keep an eye on, especially in the center of town.
So one of the things I learned at the most recent collapse of the dike was that we're on the maintenance program of every 20 years it breaks, and we scramble and we put it back to rights again. And I thought, okay, this is a critical piece of infrastructure. It's important to us, our bridges, our sewer, our water lines, and we know next to nothing about it. We don't know much about its history. We don't know what it's made of. We don't know how tall it is. We don't know. We don't know. And so we've been embarked on this project of phased approach of doing an evaluation of the dike. This is the next logical sequence of that phased evaluation of the dike, so that we know basically what's it made of, where are the weak points, what's the structural, what is its structure below the surface like. I think we need to do this.
And now, don't you think that the originators of that dike, the Army Corps of Engineers, would get involved with this? But they don't.
They don't. They wash their hands.
They wait until there's a disaster, and then they get involved.
It's worse than that. The watershed people are telling what you can and cannot do on the waterways next to the water. So, you know, they're telling you what you can and can't do, yet fix every problem that, you know, occurs.
That's a long,
This is basically preventive maintenance, right?
It's an analysis.
I think it's just basic learning what the heck
it is.
Baseline data.
We don't know how bad
I guess maybe, Marlo, could you give us a little update of what we do to maintain that dike presently? We cut off the trees, and what is, like, the maintenance budget for that?
Well, we, we're waiting to have it cut down. We should have somebody here in the next week or two, but we also inspect the drain pipe that comes off that, and we inspect it every few days to a week, a visual, to make sure everything's okay. Other than that, as far as I know, there's not much more to it.
So
that's two drain pipes.
Two,
One on Middle Street, one on West Street.
So on my computer, I look at the NOAA river stations, and look at, every spring I do this, I look at where there's going to be flooding in the valley, and I know if there's going to be flooding anywhere, happens in Hadley first. So we go through this every spring, where I lose a lot of sleep looking at that river go up and up and up.
Well, I think this goes in the category of failure is not an option. We've already had one dike failure. We spent, we all know the story there on the costs associated with that, but we had consultants, and Donald, this predates you, we did have consultants come in, and they did a recommended approach, and it was in three phases, I think, maybe four. So they were quite anxious for us to move forward with this 2 years ago, I want to say. So here we are 2 years later.
I was quite aware of it. I was on the board when the dike broke, and we had to find the money to repair it. So I know what we're talking about here.
I meant the consultant's report is what I was referring
since
to.
Since then.
That you might have missed. So at any rate, I mean, I know I'm adamantly in favor of moving this forward, but if we want to hold off for capital planning, it's whatever's a pleasure.
No, I think
there's a question on that.
We're going to be borrowing the money again for this.
Right.
I think it's another thing. for the Finance Committee and Capital Plan to review and get back to us. It's a major borrowing.
Okay, John, quickly.
I think the biggest problem with your dike and what happened over a long term is lack of maintenance. Lack of maintenance and water control, the burrow holes that start erosion, the trees, all this kind of erosion that's going on. And, you know, this is what happens, and this is what starts that. And it's just not in Hadley. It's a lot of other communities.
I think you're right, John, because you remember going back and how things were so tight. We had to shut off 439 streetlights in this town, and they never came back on. And that was part of that whole era when we just didn't have the money for anything to balance our budgets. And so a lot of the dike maintenance was deferred. You know,
the lights still are not.
Right, so we'll hold this until the capital planning meets.
You know,
so Article 6.
Another big issue that's coming down the road with that river, and I'm sure, John, you've noticed it, since they've closed Vermont down, the power station, the river froze over solid, and it wasn't even that cold last year. So eventually what's going to happen in a cold winter, like happens up in Bellows Falls, is it's such a small cavity where the rocks come down through the river at Bellows Falls, similar to what we have at Mount Tom here in Holyoke Range. There's only so much room for so much water, and if it ice jams at those particular points, mm-hmm. you're looking at a major catastrophe.
Well, that's okay. Why we need to keep
water up to the town hall like it was night. Back in the 30s.
Yeah, okay, but Donald's asked that we hold this until we get the recommendation.
I know you just finished your house, Mike, but I hate to break it back.
So, Article 6, the fire substation. $300,000.
Okay. David, at the last meeting, we were inquiring, at least I was inquiring about, there was a conversation about the storage for the newly arriving fire truck, and Mike talked to us about a plan, you know, between Hampshire Mall and moving some things around, that we can buy some time and avoid the immediate issue of what are we going to do with the new fire truck when it comes in. And then there was further conversation about considering a modification for, you know, $5,500 or $5,800 to the bay doors of the North Hadley Hall. And then this, and whether or not it made sense to spend that money to again buy some time for reaching an ultimate decision up there. And then I posed the question about whether or not there was any alternative, since right now that building is, you know, for sale slash there's an offer on the table to buy it. We don't know the future of the building, whether or not there was any alternative to that. So do you have any?
Right, so the chief and I met with Five Colleges Farms up on where the old Montgomery Rose used to be. We looked over the available space there, met with Mr. Keith Rabine, and they're very agreeable that they could put together something. You talked about the temporary operating quarters out of the farm there, and I talked about temporary storage facilities there. Seems like they could accommodate both our requests. They are willing to make modifications to the buildings to basically build to suit at a very reasonable price, which they're drawing up for us. But we talked about a very low price per square foot. So it looks like that's a viable option.
How much money?
They haven't given us a quote, but we're looking at a very, very reasonable rate.
I've also spoken to Mr. Zagrodnik. He has, if you know his facility there, two doors, 14 by 14 and about 100 foot long. He would be interested in giving one side for the new fire truck too, possibly if it came to that, at a much reduced rate. Somebody should probably talk to him.
Okay.
Which is, what is that property? I don't know this one.
It's on Knightley Road.
Knightley Road.
Okay.
It's in North Hadley and Knightley Road, and it's a heated facility.
All right, so we have options.
It's like Hatfield did with their fire truck. Was it Mr. Belden's fire?
It's like what we did with our fire truck on your...
Yes, it was in the garage for quite some time, yeah.
Everything that you referred to the last time you spoke to us, going to the mall, is smaller things.
Correct.
Some of the museum pieces possibly.
Correct.
But not a fire truck.
No.
Right.
No.
I want
just storage,
to emphasize
yeah.
that.
All right, Article 6.
So Article 6, so people comfortable voting on this tonight? People feel that they have enough information? People are...
On
Article 6?
I thought we're talking, that's Article 8, isn't it?
Six.
No, this is the first one.
There's two of them.
Oh, the public.
The two of them.
Yeah.
The first one is the...
Oh.
Maybe I'm on the wrong page.
Under motion 7.
9. Page 9.
Yeah.
Bottom of page 9.
You're on page 11.
So it's a borrow of $3.6 million to design and build a substation for the fire department?
Right here.
Yeah.
That's the HVAC you're talking about there.
I don't think that's the right thing.
Donald, look at page 10.
Here.
I printed the one off that was on board docs.
The one I was handed today in my agenda.
Here, try this one.
Here's it.
And the one I was handed in my agenda is completely different.
$3.6 million.
Well, I don't think that $3.6 million, you know, I'm a neighborhood representative. I don't vote on that committee, but I've had a lot of input from that committee in the last 3 months, and that figure possibly is going to be reduced under $3 million. And the North Hadley Hall itself, to put the new fire truck in, to revamp it for $5,500, that's a no-brainer, and not rent anywhere. Just get it done, put the truck in there, and we'll buy time. You know, with town meeting, we'll see what they say about the hall. We don't know, that's a hypothetical. But we have a place to put that truck. Let's get it done, put it in there, and we're done with that situation, I think. I don't know what the chief's recommendation is, but I guess
voted.
We'd like to hear from you.
Yeah, you were going to take the $5,500 out of your budget to do whatever we needed to get the truck in there.
No, that was one of the options. It was I was asked to go out and talk with the mall
if
about
we needed
the small storage.
Yeah,
and
we could get the money to do it without... so I think last time, didn't we vote to approve that $5,800, but pending additional information?
Correct.
Right. So it's ready to roll whenever we're ready to
pull the trigger on it.
Well, the discussion, we were going to wait for town meeting. Wasn't that how it ended? How town meeting gave us some direction before he went and did the remodel at North Hadley Hall?
Right. No remodeling, but
yeah,
place
until that.
Yeah.
Are we still feel that way?
I still feel that way.
I do too. That's fine.
When is the fire truck coming in?
Yeah. Now, what about the, even if it passes, it's going to take a year to build it.
No, we're talking about revamping the North Hadley fire station, which wouldn't take long at all, I don't think, right?
Hopefully not.
Fire truck.
Yeah. But in the interim, you're saying end of the month or when now possibly that truck is coming?
They told us potentially we would be out viewing it and making sure everything's correct at the end of the month. It may be another week for transport. It goes for a week to a place out near Boston to get lettered. So, like I said, it could be 3 to 6 weeks. I wish I could give you a more definitive date, but that's the closest I can.
So then I think we could wait till town meeting. Take the little chance we have to and see what the direction is from that.
Town meeting's in 2 weeks.
We're not cold enough where if we had to, you know, I mean, not the new truck, but we could move stuff around outside right now if we had to.
How long would it take you to modify North Hadley Fire Station by spending the $5,800? How long would it take?
If we can get a contractor lined up, it shouldn't take more than, I'd say, a couple days.
Okay, thanks.
So this article, though, has to do with spending $3.6 million on a North Hadley substation. So that's the article that's in front of us for discussion. I'll just go on record saying right now, I'm not comfortable that we've fully vetted all of the options in advance of special town meeting. So I'm actually not, I'm not against the North Hadley substation, but I think that we still have more work to do. And I think that work includes making sure that if in fact we move forward with one, it's done on the best location possible. I'm still not convinced that this site is. I know the number's in question, the size of the building is still in question, and I feel like going in front of fall town meeting with this article in support of it, I'm having difficulty with right now. I would rather find a temporary solution and defer the actual approval of the construction of a substation until the spring.
And my thoughts are, we already own that piece of property. I can't see going and buying another piece of property when we already own something, because we're throwing money away someplace else. I feel that North Hadley needs a substation. Whether it's going to cost $3,600,000, I don't know. It's a number. But I do feel like we need to move forward with this. I think we've sat long enough on it. And I would recommend moving forward with it and letting at least, you know, I have my own thoughts, but again, it goes to town meeting, mm-hmm. and it lets the people at town meeting vote on it and decide what they want to do.
Right. Well, we're only addressing the select board.
Correct. I'm in favor of moving it forward.
Yeah. And just to add to my thinking, I mean, one of the things we're talking about right now is it's been abundantly clear that the building committee made it clear that their priority to support public safety was to really focus on modifications to Central Station, which is where, I mean, that really is where the primary force is located. Mike made a recommendation and the select board approved it unanimously to move forward with the SAFER grant, to move from a call force to a full-time day force, recognizing that wouldn't happen for a multi-year period, but we all said that we supported that. If that SAFER grant comes through, even if it doesn't come through, I think that we still have to be having that discussion for the greater good of the town, that does it make sense that we're at the point that we need to at least go to a full-time day force. And the more I look at the numbers about these buildings, what Mike said to us last week, smack me if I'm wrong, but what I heard you say is that in your professional opinion, as long as we had any call force, even if the call force was isolated to the evening hours, that you would still recommend we had a presence in North Hadley, right? And so then I'm also wanting to have more discussion about, are we ultimately heading to a 24/7 fire department? And if that's the case, then I have to start questioning whether or not we need that presence in North Hadley. And I know I'm talking 5 years out, you know, but $3.6 million is an awful lot of money to be spending on something. And this is one time where I'd like to take a step back and say, are we better off renting or coming up with a temporary solution for a year while we really fully vet that and give the chief an opportunity to come up with a longer range plan for the department? So I'm not saying it as any sort of slap about North Hadley. I totally get the numbers and the whys and wherefores of the call force and response times for the residents. But if 5 or 6 years from now we're talking about 24/7 fire department coverage and everybody's coming out of Central Station, then I don't know. So we haven't had that discussion, but.
I guess I beg to differ with you, because the information that was given us from the Municipal Building Committee, their number one recommendation was to build a substation in the northern section of town. Now that we have the lot at no cost to us, they've said that it's a bona fide lot now that the building isn't going to be there, and we reduced the building which allows us even more land. That hasn't come to a vote, it'll be coming up, and that was their recommendation. The number one recommendation was public safety and establish a building in the northern section of town.
I'm pretty sure it was Central Station was their number one recommendation, making modifications.
No, their recommendation, if you look at the building and needs report, that's what it was. Number one was North Hadley Substation.
Have we received the OPM suggestion yet?
No.
Did I weigh in on this?
Not yet.
Chris, you want to make a motion, I'll second your motion, if that's on the table.
John, do you have, you want to chime in?
I'm not for making it fit on that piece of property, but I am for putting it on town meeting floor in front of the people, and if that's the direction we need to go in, and that's going to be the substation, we absolutely need a substation North Hadley, no matter where you put it or how big you built, but build it so it can be added on at some point, sometime. Because you know the inevitable is you're gonna need it for storage, equipment, house people. You don't know what you're gonna do with it. And you're in a civil defense now. You're in this game, and you see what's happening down in North Carolina right now. Mm-hmm. It took 5 days for the federal government to get there. You're on your own for 5 days, like I said last week. That's what happens. And we're not prepared for a major emergency here.
That substation is also being proposed as the new civil defense area for the town. It'll have a heating and cooling facility for any emergency, like the snow emergency when all the trees came down like 2 years ago and people didn't have anywhere to go in this town. They would be able to set up there, and it would eliminate the problem in this town. We use the schools presently, but they're not adequate to do the job.
How many people are you going to fit in there?
Probably 200.
I'll make a motion to...
Jerry hasn't chimed in yet.
Oh, Jerry, I'm sorry.
No, I feel that it's just too big a facility. We're talking about too big a facility and spending too much money on 3.6. I absolutely agree we need something up there. I just don't think we need something the size of Central Station in North Hadley.
Can I speak now?
Hang on. Just making sure the board, you're not on the board.
Yes.
So, any further conversation amongst the board?
Do you have a comment about this? I know you want us to make a vote on it, but independently how you feel, you've spoken so many times in support of this building, and I would like to hear you again.
What's the general consensus of the rest of the volunteers? Like, I spoke with a lot of them.
Some of them, you know, some of them agree that, you know, they're... We've talked to a number of them. There's some that feel one way and some that feel the other. Some feel that it's too big. Some feel that we're, again, trying to plan for the future. We're trying to have a redundancy here, and that no matter what goes on with a full-time department, we're always going to be supported by a call force department. And you don't know today, tomorrow, who's going to be living up in that neck of the woods, who'd be responding to that. I can tell you, last night, Engine 2 was the second truck on scene at a chimney fire in Hockenham. So again, you have call force guys getting to a station extremely quickly and getting out the door because they live right down the street. So, you know, again, I know very much about emergency management and civil defense, and I did set up a warming and cooling and spent many hours sitting there making sure that residents had a place when we had that major snow event for multiple days, so they could come in and get a hot bowl of soup and charge their cell phones. We also had Halloween there, if folks remember. The kids came in and had trick-or-treat there. So I'm very well-versed in how to set up an emergency management shelter, regional supplies. We have regional supplies at the Hampshire Mall. And so in my opinion, I agree with John that we need to be able to be expandable, and we need to be able to provide the citizens in North Hadley and in, you know, downtown. Again, you never know when something's going to come through. Look what happened in Springfield with a tornado that took out multiple locations. The weather's not getting any easier. So we, as firefighters, we always plan for the worst. And so that's my recommendation. I've been doing risk analysis ad nauseum, and giving everybody facts and figures, driving the road so you could get, you know, get a perspective of how long it takes. Myron Chudzik did it prior to 1996. That's the information I presented at the last meeting, where the potential of an ambulance coming through and where we should locate the center station at the time to try and figure out where our 4 and 5 mile percentages of what we would be able to cover for the town. So my recommendation is you need something in North Hadley, and it should be, I thought that the secondary idea that we came up with that lowered the cost was a very reasonable sized structure that would allow for both police and fire to fit into that space if need be, if something happened to our center station. And it would also allow for us to build out, as in the 5-year plan that I proposed to you with the SAFER grant that started. Still haven't heard back yet, but haven't gotten the rejection letter yet, which is good. But you know, we're looking potentially at trying to level off the cost of the fire department by supporting the fire department and civil defense with the operation of an ambulance service. So potentially that ambulance service could even move into the North Station. You know, I've had people asking me about you know, how many calls, you know, that Amherst can always come here, and Amherst fire trucks can always be here before Hadley firefighters can get there. And please check on the Facebook page of Amherst Fire, their union, and you can see how overstrained they are.
Let me attest to that. I had one day, I had 6 Amherst ambulances at the hospital. They had one guy left at their station to go with a truck for a fire. What does that tell you about their staffing? Now let's be realistic here. Yes. You'd always say, and they've always been so dependable for us, you cannot knock that. But they're stretched right now. So these are things that we need to look at also.
Right, but we're not talking about that.
And
I don't think we're even talking really about whether or not ultimately, again, I think right now what you've heard is everybody's saying we have recognized there's a need in North Hadley. I'm saying I don't think that the proposal that we've seen for the 3.6, which is the article in front of us, is the right size. I know that there's work being done to come up with a different solution, and I also question whether or not that site is so constrained that if we truly mean what we say, which is we want to make sure we're building it for the future, and we don't know what that future is yet because the ambulance committee hasn't met and we don't know where we're going yet with the ambulance service, whether or not feasibly we can get by deferring this decision to the spring when we have more time and it's more fully vetted. That's what I'm struggling with. I don't feel like we have really vetted all of the options in front of us right now, which is why I'm not prepared to vote in favor of a $3.6 million North Hadley substation. Please tell your guys, I'm not against the substation, but I don't feel like this is the best information. So it's threads of what other people are saying.
Well, the one thing we know is that it has to go on the agenda, that the people have to have their chance to vote for it. So it's really out of our hands. You know, if there's any other article that's on here, it's not us that's going to make the long shot call here.
But they want to, I mean, the reason the select board votes is they want to know what we think. Yeah. I mean, we have to take a role here.
Yeah.
Yes, John?
Yeah. Now, there's 5 of you selectmen. I know 2 of you were opposed to this.
I'm sorry.
About the rest of you 3?
2 of you, what'd you say?
I know 2 of you guys are opposed to it. Jury's opposed
to this article.
For the size.
Did you?
Size.
We're trying to accommodate that by cutting 20 feet off that building. Which would in turn cut the cost. I talked to the OPM about this. He looked at it. I says, is this suitable for the site? Absolutely. He's working with Frank Quadro on a price to hopefully get things moving for a town meeting. I know the fire chief, I have been in here numerous times already talking this over and over, right? I don't know how much more information you need. We're ready to go with it. Maybe you're not, but we are. And we want the opportunity to go in front of town meeting, hopefully with a support from our selectmen. Maybe we won't get them all, but maybe we'll get a majority of this board that would support a much needed fire station and protection. We got over $1 million homes in North Hadley they need protection. They're paying for that. They're entitled to that. And I hope this board doesn't deny them that. And I would ask you, at least maybe three of you, for your support, for a vote, to support this for town meeting. People look at support from the selectmen, not just throw it in front of the board, the town meeting, and let townspeople decide.
Jane?
What's the difference between Article 6 and Article 8, except Article 8 doesn't have any numbers in it?
No, it's still a petition, that's all.
Yeah.
So Article 8 and Article 9, let's cover those together. These are, the way that the petitions are written, it's more of a resolution rather than a legislative appropriation of money. So basically we're resolving, or if this passes, it's the town is resolving to instruct the select board to take certain actions. It doesn't compel them to take those actions. So it's more of a statement of resolve rather than a legal action such as an appropriation for money.
But if Article 6 passes, this is Article 8 passes over. There's no need of dealing with it.
Correct.
Right.
Plus Article 8, correct me if I'm wrong, if that 3.6 million is stated there by petition, it cannot be changed.
It's not there.
Cannot be lowered or higher.
It's not there.
So which article are we talking about?
She asked about Article 8, how it differs from Article 6. Okay. By petition, you're set with that figure and it cannot be adjusted.
You're on the wrong
page.
This is the wrong page. Article 6 is not by petition. This is it here.
Right.
Just 8.
Which one? You were saying the one by petition with the fire station she mentioned. That's what I'm referring to.
There's no figure on Article 8.
There's no figure.
Okay, see, there we go again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Read what you got
to say. No, he's got the wrong one. He's got the one we got on our board docs. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so.
Okay, there's no figure. Okay, on that.
So, do we want to vote on Article 6? You guys ready to vote?
Yeah, take a vote on.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to accept Article 6.
Is there a second?
I second the motion.
Okay.
Okay, all
in favor of Article 6, say aye.
Wait a minute, you're not talking about putting it on, you're talking about supporting.
Yeah, this is that you're supporting the actual article as written, 3.6 million.
It's on.
Yep. Again, that amount
there's a motion
very,
on the floor.
Very well could be lowered.
Yeah.
At that.
Depending
so.
On the design change, yep.
Right.
Yep.
And then we're leaning towards that.
So, in reverse, if we, you know, we can't, we're at the, never mind, I'll wait until it gets to the next one.
Okay. I know where you're going. Okay, so motion made and Donald seconded Joyce's motion. Okay, all in favor of Article 6, say aye.
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 Okay, opposed?
Aye.
Aye. So no, three, no, two.
Article 7 is petition article having to do with the senior center. The motion specifies $3.5 million for the project.
I don't see a number there.
So Article 7, if you look at the article, there's no motion, but if you look at them.
Okay.
That's a ballpark estimate because we haven't had any thing except the conceptual estimate that was done by David Tudrin, and we tried to correlate what we had seen from other senior centers.
So shouldn't that 3.5 be in the original petition? No.
That is not what people sign.
It can't
that
be changed.
Be changed.
The original, this is a different article than we had on all the other drafts.
No.
The 3.5 was in the other articles, I believe.
No.
You sure?
It was always in the motion, never in the article.
Always in the motion. We couldn't put a number on it. So this is by petition. It's the same as number 8. This is by petition. That's by petition, number 7.
They always talk about 3.5.
Right. that's the ballpark estimate that we had to run with because we didn't have.
So I guess my question to you is, what is the actual cost if it isn't 3.5?
We have been waiting for an OPM to give us that answer, and they cannot give it to us before town meeting, so that's best guess.
Because I'm confused. When we talk about the sub-fire station, originally it was 6,500 square feet, 3.6 million. Reduced to 52 is maybe 2.8 million. The library is approximately 9,600, 7 million. I understand yours is close to 13,000 square feet.
It's 10,000 square feet plus the 30% for quarters, storage, and mechanics.
So it's bigger than the library, but half the price. That's what I don't understand.
I think it's more open.
Library, half the funding is coming from my old school.
No, this doesn't include the funding. I'm talking about the total cost of building the building.
I understand what your statement is, which is part of why we had been asking to try and get some professional movement towards costing it out other than just the initial cost estimate put out by the Municipal Building Committee and David Tudrin, who we think did a great job, but that's what we have to go by because we didn't get any services prior to that.
Right. The OPM
I guess all I'm trying to say, the average building is about $350 per square foot. When you multiply 350 times 9,600, it's a much different price than 3.5.
That's not necessarily true, because their building is cheaper than our building. That's not necessarily
Having said that,
they've got a lot more open space than their building. Yeah.
We plan on being conservative with what we need to do. We've got a great plan in place insofar as laying out our program needs, and that has been shown to the OPM. They said we did a great job clarifying what we needed, and David Tudrin's initial cost estimates.
Well, and they do relate to some of the buildings we met and their costs and their square footage. Because a senior center doesn't have all the technology and stuff that a fire station has or a library has. We're a different.
We have 60 by 40 open space where the trucks are going in, nothing there.
Well, they have a right to.
I realize that, but I guess I feel like our chairman did with the last one. I don't have enough information about your building to even render a vote because you don't have the correct figures.
How many square feet?
Well, you don't know that they're incorrect.
How many square feet did you say your building was? 10,000?
Correct.
And then 30% for storage?
Correct.
Donald, how do you think it's so far off? If you use the 350 number that you utilize times 10,000, you come up with $3.5 million, and I assume the storage space is far less expensive to build. I don't see
what about all the soft costs? What about the excavating?
The drainage
on the North Hadley Fire Station alone is $125,000. Their lot is much bigger. It's probably going to be closer to $200,000. Okay. All of those figures, I don't know if they're in there or not. Apparently, they can't be.
They're not comparable. You got the pond there. You've got to take into consideration.
The pond has nothing to do with it. We don't even border it.
The soft costs were added into David Tudrin's initial cost estimates.
Mm-hmm. And he does this for a living.
Yeah, he's an architect.
So what are you complaining about? Why don't you run with it and see what happens?
That's exactly it.
That's what we want to do.
So is anybody else on the select board have something to say?
In fairness to them, they wanted to be sure, they wanted the OPM to go over things to make sure.
They wrote us a letter that they wouldn't have theirs or they wouldn't have ours.
Huh?
What?
They didn't have enough time to.
They didn't have enough time to put everything together for their project and our project.
Right.
Right? You got a letter for
correct.
That.
Correct.
You a letter for this?
Right.
They stated in the meeting that they did not expect to have anything for us to, anything new to present for town meeting.
Okay, so further questions, comments, Article 9?
Article seven.
Seven. Jeez, I'm sorry, okay, yeah, look back, yep. Article seven?
I'll make a motion to accept.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No.
Okay, so 4-1-0.
You vote.
John, did you vote?
Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just voted in favor. And the previous article, Jennifer, was 3-2? Yep.
Four.
Okay, so let's do Article 8 and Article 9 together.
Okay.
Because, again, there's statements of resolve, not action.
Okay.
All right, the one is to build a fire station, and the other one is to demolish North Hadley Village Hall.
Hallelujah. Make a motion to accept. He won't get that out of me.
That's for two articles.
For the two of them, yes, I'll take both of them. Do a second.
You're making a,
oh, well,
taking them both together, 8 and 9.
Yeah.
And you're making a motion to accept them.
Yeah.
I'll second your motion.
Okay.
The petition anyway.
Just accepting the petitioned articles?
Just to recommend.
Petition and the,
yeah. How did you state that the last time you're making a motion to
accept the petition
recommend it for town meeting?
Yeah. That would be it.
Well, wait a minute. So the first one is to construct North Hadley Fire Substation.
See, I'm for that. I just.
That's a matter of.
Let's
do
them independently.
Yeah.
All right, well, Article 8, I make a motion to accept Article 8.
I'll second that.
And on that lot, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And no, for the reasons I stated before. Okay, Article 9.
Make a motion to accept.
To demolish North Hadley Hall within a 2-year period?
Yeah.
And again, this is a statement of resolve. There's no practical effect of this article.
Correct.
So are we resolved to demolish the building that we sold?
Right.
Okay.
You didn't sell it yet.
Joyce has got it sold. Don't put your paper up when we get to this one.
Yeah, don't put my paper up. I'll strike the match.
Okay, so is there a motion?
Don't burn down tonight.
Motion made. Is there a second on Joyce's motion?
Halloween's coming.
Okay.
Oh, boy.
Okay, is there a second on Joyce's motion?
Only in Hadley.
Come on, let's keep it on track, guys. We got an executive
Any
session.
Second to my motion?
I'll second. I having a hard time keeping track of these motions.
Okay. All right, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No?
No.
No.
3-2.
3-2.
You have 3-2?
Yeah. Moving along.
Okay. Articles 10 and 11 are the two libraries articles. You've seen these before. Again, there's no appropriation of money, but we did take that into account when we showed you those borrowing scenarios.
I guess my feeling on this one, this is exactly the same article that was presented at town meeting, and it was voted no overwhelmingly. So I don't see any different why the town meeting would have to go at it again after they emphatically voted no.
One of the things that I see as different, Donald, this time is that the senior center has a plan in front of it, and if that gets approved, we are not throwing people out of a building in order to build a new building. So I think people will have less of a, will be less offended by the thought process of putting the library where Hooker School is now if it's vacated. That's my humble opinion.
What we don't have here in support of the library is cost of taking down Hooker School.
That was included
was
in the price.
In.
It was folded into the price.
Folded into the price,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So again, this is a non-monetary article. It merely allows the library folks to move forward to apply for the grant money. So town meeting will have a bite at the apple to go yay or nay on an actual building in the future.
You need to say that very clearly.
Yeah, we will. We will. John?
Yeah. Say if that theirs passed, the senior center, they don't get their grant, I want to know what you're going to do with that building. You're going to have another skeleton there to deal with.
And we'll have to deal with it.
I want to know now what your intentions are.
Take it down.
Yeah.
At what cost?
We'll have to figure that one out.
We'll have to figure
it out. Well, don't you think you should figure that out before you go to town meeting? Because that's going to be asked at town meeting. You're the administration.
So one of the things that we have to keep in mind is as we move through our building process, we're going to need swing space. So tearing down the building may not be the first right best answer. Tearing it down eventually, yes, but we may need to relocate a whole series of compartments over there in order to take care of another building elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Mm-hmm. So then you got to build a new library, you know, rebuild that.
The North Hadley Hall, we put a bunch of historical restrictions on whether the town votes to tear it down or not. That one's kind of a sticky point for me. But as far as the center of town, Russell School, the town hall, the library, and the old Hooker School, is through like four generations of my family been through all those schools. It's the last little piece of history we have left in this town. We've got the Farm Museum over here, along with the First Church, and this is all we have, you know? Before we think about tearing that Hooker School down, I think there's gonna be a lot of thought going into this. There's gonna be a lot of people looking at the history of Hadley and what we're doing to the center of town where it was all started.
You guys don't have answers to that. You can have a
John,
lot of debate.
John, you're out of order, okay. Are we ready to vote on Article 10?
Yeah.
Is there a motion?
Motion.
10 and 11?
10 and 11?
Yeah. Put it on.
Okay. Is there a motion?
Second.
Put it on. Second. Okay. All in favor of Articles 10 and 11? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. No.
Opposed?
No.
Okay.
Everybody has a right to vote for it, whether they want to. I mean, everybody has their choice.
Yeah, they already have.
Okay, Articles 12 and 13. These are related articles. Number 12 is the authorization to adjust fees without having to go to town meeting.
Motion accept.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 No.
No.
And can I put down that same vote for the raising of the fees?
Yeah,
that would make sense. Okay, Article 14?
It wouldn't make sense. They're saying that to change the power to it to be us, not that they shouldn't go up.
Right.
Oh, that's right.
What would be the vote on that?
Motion accept 13.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No.
No on 13? Jen?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, we can still bring it in front of town meeting floor to raise the fees.
Right, you're voting against.
Yes.
Okay. All right, Article 14 is the Municipal Modernization Act to make sure that people who are applying for licenses are in good standing with respect to their taxes.
Motion accept.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I have this on the consent agenda, I think.
Yeah, I think so too, actually.
All right. Article 15, I also have on the consent agenda, this clearing of the land transfer on Jamura Road.
Motion accept. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Gooseberry.
Okay, so the developer doesn't want to, the planning board voted that Gooseberry meets their criteria for acceptance as a public way. DPW inspected the road and found it to be in need of
Gooseberry Lane.
Gooseberry Lane.
Okay.
All right. Planning board said yes. DPW looked at it and said it needs crack sealing and it needs a water valve on lot number 3. We took that information to the developer, and the developer refused to pay for the cost. The cost is $3,000 or $4,000. It's up to the board to decide whether they want this on the agenda or not.
Make a motion not to accept
Is there a second on that?
I will second that.
Could we amend that to give him the opportunity to pay the $3,000 to $4,000 to make the remedy, and then we would accept it?
Well, it's close to town meeting.
Is that a possibility?
Yeah, you got 2 weeks, you can agree to do this, you can make your...
Right, make a contingent on it.
Yeah, if the owner agrees to do the repairs, I would vote to accept it.
There's a motion on the floor not to accept it now. I would second that motion. If we all vote that way, then he'll have a message that we can send to him that says if you do it, we'll support it.
That's fine.
Just a recommendation.
Okay, that's fine.
If it's a 5-0 vote of the, or whatever it is, of the select board that says we're not going to accept it unless you fix it, at least he's got some direction.
Okay, so motion made and seconded. All in favor of the motion not to accept?
Aye.
Aye.
John?
Yeah. Yeah, it seems like a minimal amount for what he has to do.
Okay, CPA number one, Lake Norman Dam, this is a change of timeframe in which to spend the money.
Do we have to vote on
these? Generally speaking, on...
You don't have to vote on any of these, but you can if you wish.
Pass over all of them.
That's what I say too.
Yeah.
Yep.
But they make their own cases.
Stay out of their business.
Yep, and then the zoning, the same thing?
Same thing.
Pass over.
Okay. So now we have the division of motions. And each of you have a copy of this in front of you. Mm-hmm. Article 1, who wants to speak to that?
First of all, let's identify which ones are going to be the consent agenda, please.
Right here.
So I've said consent agenda for number 3, number 4, number 17, number... 18, and I'm going to take Shrewsbury off since you voted against it.
Okay.
So that's 4 articles. HCAP transfer, fund balance transfer, bylaw good standing, and Chamorro Road land transfer.
What are you talking about?
Consent.
He's just...
Oh, consent. Yeah. Okay.
Is everybody in agreement with that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, David, the omnibus budget, do you usually do that? Or just...
I usually do that. I'd be happy to do that
All
for
right.
you.
That's good. David.
HPAT transfer, do you want me to handle that?
Sure.
Well, you want to do all the consent agendas?
Sure.
I've got Article 1, and then it goes right into 3. I know these could be renumbered.
Right. So you want me to do the consent agendas? I can do that.
I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
I'll agree with you, Molly.
Yeah.
Is there a confusion with the consent agenda sometimes needing a 2/3 and sometimes not needing a 2/3?
No, because consent would be by consent. It would have to be unanimous. If the one person objects, then we have to vote this separately.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Bond premiums applied to prior authorized debt.
I can do that if you want.
Okay.
Very exciting topic.
Mm-hmm.
Capital expenses, is that you, Jerry?
It's me.
Fire substation.
I'll go with it.
Senior center.
Me.
Petition.
Yeah, do we
want to... Okay, the two... Two petitioned ones for the fire substation and the North Hadley Village Hall.
These are petitioners, right?
Yeah.
But that's the petitioners that speak to this. Right?
Petitioners should speak to that, yeah.
Okay, so 15?
Library. Should be library.
Right.
15 MGL to adjust fees.
That's what we just voted?
Yeah. I can do that.
You can do both of them?
Sure.
Yeah.
That's
it.
Gooseberry Lane?
You mean
we'll
just explaining why we...
I guess
yeah.
give them time.
Yep.
Whoever wants it.
Give them time, I guess I can speak on it.
Okay. So, John, if... Yeah.
Way to jump in there, John.
I might as well...
You're laying in the weeds.
Well,
I thought you were going to get off without doing one of them.
Well,
all right, so, Mr. Pachinski,
do
you don't
my part
have any
here.
speaking.
That's all right.
I'll do enough speaking without talking about articles, believe me.
Do you want to do just fees?
Huh? It doesn't matter. No, I'm fine with it.
So the last order of business for tonight is to vote to sign the warrant.
So move.
Second.
Sign it away.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations, you have a warrant.
We have a warrant.
Is it a boy or a girl?
Is this warrant final though?
The numbers are going to be changed, so no. Some of those are, like, Article 2 is coming off, warrant number Article 2, so it's not finalized yet.
Otherwise,
I think it's...
It's going to be posted on the website.
And we said about Gooseberry, because Gooseberry, okay. Why'd you guys vote to approve it? Did you know that those things...
No, it's always contingent upon all the other departments, and if
So truly, you didn't support it?
Because if we knew, we would have never...
Okay, thank you.
Right.
So one thing I actually failed to mention earlier, but I did want to mention, is just in terms of people obviously can have a high degree of passion about some of these articles. Again, a reminder that people are all coming together in good faith and advocating for what they think is best for the town of Hadley. And I think we want to be especially certain that nobody is trying to unduly influence people who may have an alternate viewpoint. What I mean by that is some concern has been expressed that people are feeling that they're being, you know, backed into a corner or whatever when there's some conversation going on. Everybody should feel comfortable coming to town meeting and voting what they think is best for the town, and not feeling that there are going to be any threats or repercussions set in their direction. So I don't know why I have to say that, but I felt like I had to say that because that concern has been expressed, so I'm openly saying it tonight.
Chairman, do you want us to be prepared? Do you want us to be prepared next Wednesday night at the forum to speak to the articles that we're going to have on town meeting floor? In a separation so that all the articles don't fall in one person's lap.
Yeah,
oh, yes.
Yeah.
So actually, thank you.
Talking points for everybody.
Right. And so do you have any idea when you're going to have them so that people can kind of sign up for the ones they're comfortable talking about?
Let them do the ones that they're currently signed up for on the warrant, if that's okay.
Well, and then, but Donald should have some as well. So we want to, maybe we can work that out with Donald in advance of that. Okay.
Well, if you want Gooseberry, Donald, you can have it.
You want me to deal with Mr. Burkham, huh?
Yeah. Well, and that's another thing, too. We went over kind of the general overview, so the intent was to do what we did last time, that, you know, I'll do a brief introduction and then turn it over where David and Linda will be doing the financial information. Mm-hmm. We'll work that out. But I would ask that if anybody has anything that they feel needs to be put into that introduction, let David, myself, know in advance, because obviously, Donald, I know there are things that you wanted to say, but there were people that were kind of confused about the points you were making that may have been a little bit in conflict with what we said the board's position was. So again, if there are things that you're thinking about and you want to make sure that they get into those talking points, if you could get those to David, that would be helpful.
Soon.
Now, when we get the information from Capital Planning and the Finance Committee, would this board consider changing our votes, possibly, if we have additional information coming from them?
Changing our votes on what?
On what we voted on this evening, on some of the articles.
Yes.
Yeah.
We would reconsider, possibly?
Yes.
If there's
very good, I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Good.
Jerry didn't sign these. Why not?
Oh, how come you didn't sign them? Okay. I think the other thing, there was one other item related to the fire substation, the ad hoc, I'm sorry, the ad hoc, whatever it's called, the North Hadley Fire Station Ad Hoc Committee. Last week, John Michkowski asked that Ed DeKevitz be appointed to the committee. We said that it needed to follow the formal process and that Ed himself really needed to make a written recommendation in that regard. John did hand in a letter signed by Ed indicating that he wants to be on the committee. In the meantime, did go back, and I had asked David just to get the cobwebs off about who was appointed to the committee, because you said something about, you know, we should have five, you know, we usually have an odd number of people. And to David's and my knowledge, nobody has resigned from the committee. So it's not clear to me why we're actually, and this is nothing against Eddie. I mean, Eddie is a great addition. He has a lot of institutional knowledge about the fire department, but why are we even adding anybody to an ad hoc committee at this point?
Because one member does not come to no event, to two meetings, and not once has been called and asked. And Eddie served as civil defense director, which you can weigh in a lot of pertinent information to our downsides and what we actually need for the future of that department. So that's...
Right. So, I mean, I guess just, again, from a process standpoint, we don't have a resignation from any member, so whoever's not showing up.
But what does it hurt putting another person on that could help us?
Well, if it's the member...
You just said you're lacking information. I want to fill that gap up so that you are not lacking nothing.
Could you get us a resignation letter by any chance?
From the other person, and we can replace him?
Why? What's the difference?
I guess
Because we just don't have self-appointed ad hoc committees.
Last week, Mr. Devine made a comment. He would like to see an odd number on there. Presently, there's six. You'll add
No,
I think
five.
There's
an
odd.
Five.
There's five? Voting?
There are five. Yeah, I've got the list right here. That's what I was checking on.
Merge,
I agree with you.
John, Willie.
Willie's not on there.
No, it's Frank, Myron, Howard.
Willie's not a voting member?
No.
No. You guys voted for that.
He's been voting ever since all the meetings I went to.
You guys voted for that.
No, that's right. Yeah, no, and yeah, it is. He's the municipal building committee
representative.
Right? Yeah, so that's five. So it's Frank, Myron, Howard,
Townsend,
John, Willie,
Marjorie,
and then we have
Townsend,
Mike and Mike
and
are advisory.
Frank, and Frank, a quadro, at six.
I didn't have a
right.
Frank, a quadro, you didn't mention.
What, Marjorie Townsend?
Yes, yeah, she's mentioned. She's in there.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
There's six presently on there, not an odd number.
Not Donald, and then you.
I don't vote. I'm only an advisor.
Right.
Joyce doesn't vote. She's the fire chief doesn't vote. The police chief doesn't vote.
I thought Willie wasn't on there. I did not send Willie an appointment letter, and as I understood from speaking with the town clerk today, we did not have Willie listed as a member of the committee. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Nick, I mean, just, this is really substance over form. If Eddie wants to participate, it's an he's more than welcome to.
Well, let's get back to Willie. I know, and I asked, which Gavitt, he couldn't do it. And then I says, can we appoint Willie Dan Linkle on the Municipal Building Committee to this? And you guys voted for that. I'm going to go pick those dates up. Why do we have to do this at this stage of the game? I'm looking for more expertise, right, to get every answer, every question answered. But like yourself, Molly, you said you're not clear with a lot of things, so you should be the first one to vote for...
Well, and here's my concern is that we don't have anybody from the Finance Committee, and I think that the individual who's not attending was bringing financial expertise to the table, and we don't have anybody crunching numbers on this committee.
Frank Quaggle was on the Finance Committee.
Also.
Yeah, but I didn't think that was the role he was playing. So if in fact Frank will play that
role... He's playing finance role.
Yeah. And if he's can come and respond, be here and available for questions of a financial nature, that would be helpful.
What about Eddie?
Okay. All right. Do we want to vote to put Eddie on?
Well, let's take a vote. If it's no, it's no. If it's yes, it's yes. It's very simple.
All right, let's just put it
in my mind.
I have no problem.
I have no problem.
Yep, so all in
motion
favor?
Motion allow.
Aye.
I'm sorry. Yeah, motion made. Second?
Second.
Second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Abstain. Thank you.
Okay, so I think that wraps it up for the evening, and pardon?
I got one question. Where is the ambulance committee right now?
That's actually a question I was going to pose to the chief.
Because there's a couple other
town citizens that inquired about it, that I told to get a letter to David. I don't know if they have or not.
Okay. Sometime soon we need to have, we haven't scheduled any meetings, so the committee was formed as far as I know.
The only question is, I have not been in touch with Barbara O'Connor yet.
Right, so Barbara O'Connor and Hank.
Who else was on it?
Hank Barstow. Joyce, myself. Mike. And I think that's it, right?
I guess my question is, have you met?
No, that's.
Not at all?
No.
Not yet, no.
That was done 6 months ago, wasn't it?
No, we just, yeah, but we had.
The vote?
The vote was done, but we haven't, I mean, we're dealing with North Hadley Hall right now, and.
We're dealing with everything.
Everybody's planning the safer grant, so.
Okay, so, are there any announcements this evening?
Announce the form again. You gonna take care of the form again?
Yes, I'll do that.
Okay.
Maybe one thing before we adjourn. I'd like to have some kind of game plan. One thing we're missing every selectmen's meeting now is a reporter from the Gazette or the Springfield paper. Maybe someone can contact them to fill them out about all the Warren articles in the meeting that we're having. And maybe they could at least publish some type of article to let the people know about the meeting.
We always send them a copy of the Warren.
Yeah, but I mean more so that, you know, maybe have one come in and interview you or something and let them know what's in there, and maybe they could formulate up an article for the paper, which we need desperately to advertise that.
Yeah, in advance of the town meeting, I agree.
Yeah.
Right. So is that something that,
we always, we always send them the copy of the warrant.
Okay. And I have a reason to call the Gazette completely unrelated to the town of Hadley, so maybe when I'm in conversation, I can mention that.
I don't know if they assign a reporter anymore. Years ago, they used to all the time designate.
Yep.
You know, and now you don't see anybody anymore. Maybe there's budget cuts there too.
It's all on computer.
Yeah.
So Jerry has an announcement?
Yeah, I just want to reiterate again that the North Hadley Sugar Shack has their 18th annual Harvest Moon Pumpkin Festival and Tractor Parade on Saturday, October 15th, starting at 11 a.m. and going till 4. Birds of Prey is going to be there with Tommy Riccardi at 12:30. Parade starts at 2 p.m. Bring your tractors or ride one of the wagons. Multiple raffle tickets and award drawings are going to be done all day. It's a great time, and we thank the Boys Works for their commitment to doing it. Thanks, guys.
Any other announcements?
Are we still doing building rounds?
We are.
Yes.
And where are we going to?
Saturday. 10 o'clock Saturday morning here.
10:30, right?
10:30.
Yeah.
And I can't make that now. I've got to work.
Oh, on Saturday?
Yeah.
All right.
So 10:30?
Yeah, things between 10 and 10:30, but I don't think we're going to actually leave here until 10:30 until Joyce can get it. And then the only other final announcement would be just a reminder again, next Wednesday at 6:30, Hopkins Academy cafeteria, we're having a public forum, the purpose of which is to discuss the warrant articles from an informational standpoint only. So it's an opportunity to make sure there's clarity on what the articles mean and what a yes vote or a no vote means, and ask any clarifying questions. And then, of course, the following week, we have our special town meeting on Thursday, October 27th at 7 o'clock at Hopkins Academy. Okay? We are going into executive session, so.
I'll make a motion to go into executive session as per the provision of MGL Chapter 30A, Section 21, to discuss the reputation, character, physical condition, or mental health rather than professional competence of an individual, or to discuss the discipline or dismissal of or complaints or charges brought against a public officer, employee, staff, member, or individual, i.e. fire department. And we will not reconvene into open session.
Roll call vote, Leskovitz?
Yes.
Devine?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Trumbull?
Yes.
Kuczynski?
Yes.